This meeting will come to order.
Today we have a hearing titled "The Outbreak of Salmonella in Eggs." The chairman, ranking member, and chairman emeritus will be recognized for a 5-minute opening statement. Other members of the subcommittee will be recognized for a 3-minute opening statement. I will begin. Before we begin, I'm going to ask unanimous consent that the contents of our document binder, which will be provided at the witness table, that the documents in there, provided that the committee staff, I ask the unanimous consent that the contents of our document binder be entered into the record, provided that the committee staff may redact any information that is business proprietary, relates to privacy concerns, or is law enforcement sensitive. Without objection, the documents will be entered into the record. Today's hearing, entitled "The Outbreak of Salmonella in Eggs," will mark the 13th hearing of the Oversight and Investigations Subcommittee since January 2007 regarding food safety issues. We have examined salmonella outbreak associated with peanut butter products manufactured by the Peanut Corporation of America, which resulted in criminal investigation. Additionally, we have investigated an E. coli outbreak traced to tainted spinach, the melamine-contaminated pet food, and other food safety inquiries. Today, we will continue our examination into the food safety problems that continue to plague farms, producers, and American consumers. This time around, we're dealing with two companies producing eggs in the state of Iowa and sold nationwide. 1,608 people were infected with Salmonella enteritis from the eggs between May 1st and September 14th. What we learned about the two egg operations in Iowa that produced the tainted eggs paint a very disturbing picture of egg production in America. When FDA inspectors entered the plants in August, they found facilities riddled with unsanitary and unsafe conditions. According to the inspectors' preliminary reports, employees working within the hen-laying houses did not wear or change protective clothing when moving from house to house. Live rodents were located in the laying houses, as the picture up here shows. And you can see the eggs just to the left of the circle there. We have liquid manure oozing out of buildings there, and there's another photograph there that shows it actually coming out of a doorway. We have dead and decaying chickens found at the sites, live and dead flies too numerous to count. Most importantly, positive test results for Salmonella were found in both farms, including in the feed mill and in the water used to wash the eggs. Even more alarming, during the course of its investigation, the committee has obtained records that showed that Wright County egg tested positive for Salmonella contamination in its Iowa facilities prior to the widespread outbreak of the illness. Environmental sample reports taken in and around the chicken cages between 2008 and 2010 indicate that Wright County egg received 426 positive results for Salmonella, including 73 that were potentially positive for Salmonella enteritis, the same strain that sickened 1,600 people. Perhaps these findings should not be a surprise given the record of the DeCoster Farm operation that owns the Wright County egg facilities. In fact, DeCoster Farm had so many environmental and safety violations that the state of Iowa declared them habitual violators and assessed a total of $219,000 in civil fines. DeCoster Farm is the only entity to receive the habitual violator status from the state of Iowa. The work of this subcommittee, coupled with the work of the Health Subcommittee and the Full Committee on Food Safety, culminated in the bipartisan introduction of H.R. 2749, the Food Safety Enhancement Act. This legislation passed the committee by unanimous consent and the U.S. House of Representatives on July 30, 2009. The food safety legislation has been stalled in the Senate for more than a year. The provisions contained in our food safety legislation would address several concerns raised by this outbreak. For example, the bill would require new traceback regulations that enable the secretary to identify the history of the food as quickly as possible, but no later than 2 business days. The food safety legislation would give the FDA the needed authority to issue mandatory recalls and subpoena records of tainted food products. While in this case, the two Iowa farms did issue voluntary recalls, the FDA should not have to rely on the company's goodwill when the public health is at risk. The legislation will also give the FDA a guaranteed, consistent source of funding through the registration fees. These fees will allow the FDA to conduct more inspections, to be proactive to prevent outbreaks from occurring. We will hear testimony from witnesses with different perspectives on the recall, victims of this outbreak, the manufacturers of the recalled eggs, and a representative from the FDA. On our first panel, we have two victims that were affected by the Salmonella enteritis, Sarah Lewis and Carol Lobato. Sarah is a 30-year-old mother of two, contracted Salmonella from eating a tart at her sister's college graduation banquet. Sarah has been admitted twice to the hospital to be treated for Salmonella and is just now beginning to feel better. Sarah works at her parents' butcher shop, which they have owned since the 1970s. Sarah is very, very familiar with local and state regulations as they are subject to constant inspections. Carol is a 77-year-old mother of four and grandmother of four. When Carol and her husband took her grandson out to dinner in Colorado, she contracted Salmonella. Carol is very familiar with egg farms as she was raised in Iowa on a chicken farm. Carol spent 5 days in the hospital suffering from toxic shock, severe diarrhea, and vomiting. Our second panel will include Austin DeCoster. Austin DeCoster, owner of Wright County Egg. His son, Peter DeCoster, chief operating officer. Orland Bethel, president of Hillendale Farms of Iowa. And Dwayne Maskow, production manager, Hillendale Farm of Iowa. It's my sincere hope that these gentlemen will be forthcoming regarding the events of the outbreak and what they're doing to ensure eggs produced on their farms are safe for the American people. On the third and final panel, we'll have Dr. Josh Sharfstein, Deputy Commissioner from the Food and Drug Administration. I look forward to hearing from our witnesses today about the progress that has been made since the outbreak occurred and how we can strengthen our food safety system. Our committee began pushing for reform of the food safety system more than 3 years ago. Our hearings have demonstrated the weaknesses in our food safety system and will remain and will demonstrate the weaknesses in our food safety systems that will remain until we enact an effective food safety bill into law. Make no mistake about it. Without legislative action, it is not a matter of if, but when more lives will be put at risk by another outbreak, as evident by today's hearing. This outbreak affected more than 1,600 individuals, two of which are here to tell their story today. Fortunately, no one has died. In each of our 13 food safety hearings, we are reminded that each year, approximately 76 million Americans become sick from foodborne disease, such as Salmonella. 325,000 are hospitalized, and 5,000 deaths will occur in the United States. It's time to give our regulators the tools they need to be proactive in the fight against foodborne illnesses and disease. I yield back the balance of my time. I next turn to the ranking member of the subcommittee, Mr. Burgess of Texas, for an opening statement. Mr. Burgess.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to thank you and our witnesses who are here with us today for participating in this very important hearing, because once again, as you've already articulated, we find ourselves in the middle of a foodborne illness outbreak, this time involving the safety of a food item that we frequently buy, eat, and serve to our families. Just this morning, I viewed pictures taken by the Food and Drug Administration at both companies' egg production facilities during the FDA inspections. These photos document some extremely unsanitary and unsightly conditions, including piles of chicken manure that was pushed up against an open doorway and leaking outside a laying house, dead flies by the thousands, rodent holes, structural damage to buildings, and chicken carcasses. Now, these companies must be able to account for and respond to these photos, and I'm also anxious to ask the Food and Drug Administration if the public can take comfort in the fact that these observations are not normal. I wonder if the FDA will be able to answer this question, considering that they have not inspected any other egg production facilities besides these two in quite some time. To date, the Centers for Disease Control has reported that over 1,500 illnesses are likely to be associated with Salmonella in eggs. I want to thank our first panel of witnesses, both victims of this outbreak, for appearing today to share your stories. The outbreak of Salmonella in eggs is unique in that the Salmonella contamination is not from the shell, but from the interior of the egg. Test results indicate that the laying hens themselves were infected with Salmonella, and the hens passed the contamination through the inside of the eggs. One very important fact about the investigation, perhaps an indication that this hearing is held before we have all the facts is that the ultimate source of the salmonella contamination is not yet certain. Concerns about the feed given to the young chickens and the unsanitary conditions at the suspect farms have been raised. I hope that the testimony provided today will move us closer to understanding the original source of the contamination and how to prevent it from ever happening again. By early August, the traceback investigations completed by the CDC, the FDA, and the state partners indicated a common source of contamination from a single farm owned by the DeCoster family. On August 13, Wright County Egg issued a voluntary recall of approximately $380 million, and on August 19, Hill and Dale, owned by Mr. Orlando Bethel, issued a voluntary recall of eggs after being suspected as a potential source of contamination. Responsible corporate actors are crucial in maintaining a safe and reliable food industry. Companies must observe good manufacturing and agricultural practices. The documents and subsequent photographs obtained by this committee raise serious questions about whether both of these companies were consistently maintaining such good practices. Of particular interest are the documents that show the test results done on behalf of DeCoster Farms in 2008 through 2010. The occurrence of salmonella positive environmental samples is frequent. 72 of environmental sponges were tested for salmonella and only 8 were negative. Experts who have spoken to staff have indicated that environmental samples that turn up positive for salmonella may be expected on a farm and do not necessarily indicate that the food end product is contaminated. But I want to know if these findings warrant cause for alarm and become troublesome if positive results become a pattern and are not rectified. I want to ask the DeCosters about these tests and what the company gleaned from this information, and I'm also interested in what the FDA has to say about this as well. Other documents obtained by the committee include numerous sanitation reports completed by the Department of Agriculture and Marketing Services, some of the hazard plans, unsatisfactory sanitary conditions, an array of observations at Wright County Egg over a 4-year period of time. I would like Mr. DeCoster to comment and explain these records. Although the Food and Drug Administration has told my staff that the eggs have historically been considered a high-risk food product, the FDA did not inspect these egg facilities prior to the outbreak. During the inspections discussed in the FDA Form 483, the investigators noted that each company failed to fully implement and follow procedures in their salmonella prevention plans, and now we have the pictures to document that failing. Tests conducted in August by FDA investigators at Wright County Egg were positive for the same and other strains of salmonella. These samples were taken from manure pits, walkways, chicken feeds, and other surfaces. I want an up-to-date report from the companies and the FDA explaining where the exact matches of salmonella to the outbreak strain that caused human illnesses were found and how the companies and the Food and Drug Administration interpret these results. It is important for the FDA as well as the industry to work cooperatively internally with other federal agencies and with health and agricultural departments to reduce the number of and help prevent foodborne illness. A new egg rule became effective this July that addressed several of these concerns associated with eggs involved in this outbreak. However, it took the Food and Drug Administration over 10 years to act on this issue, illustrating the continued systemic, problematic, and bureaucratic weaknesses that plague the Food and Drug Administration. The future FDA should not be a reactive body. It should be proactive. Mr. Chairman, I support conducting this investigation and holding a hearing. I am concerned that we're not always done in a most bipartisan and useful manner. September 9, I sent a letter to you stating that I thought the CEO of the FDA, the commissioner of the FDA, Dr. Margaret Hamburg, should be here to offer the agency's official testimony. She and the Obama administration have repeatedly stated publicly that food safety and the resources of the FDA is a top priority and must be taken seriously, quickly addressed. In the 110th Congress, Commissioner Andrew von Eschenbach was here 4 times and testified on food safety. The majority declined to invite a representative from the United States Department of Agriculture to testify, even though the committee sent a document request to the agency, held a briefing, and received thousands of pages of relevant information concerning their role in the regulation of these farms and this outbreak. Staff has obtained and reviewed relevant, revealing USDA documents, including USDA shell egg plant system, audit reports, preoperative sanitation reports, and a USDA inspector notes and observations from Wright County Egg. This hearing would be more productive if a USDA official were here to answer questions related to these documents and perhaps answer the number one question, why didn't you say anything to the Food and Drug Administration? The ultimate goals of this hearing are good, and I support the food safety legislation that this House has passed in 2009. I'm eager for the Senate to move on this important issue. Mr. Chairman, I thank you for your forbearance, and I'll yield back the balance of my time.
Gentleman's time expired. Mr. Waxman, Chairman of the Full Committee, for an opening statement, please.
Thank you very much, Chairman Stupak, for calling this hearing. And before I address the concerns of this hearing specifically, I want to thank you for a record of 4 years of diligence in pursuing issues of food safety. Your work stands out as a model of congressional oversight and investigation, and you have illustrated very clearly the need for stronger food safety laws. You've had 13 hearings in the last 4 years. You educated the members of this committee and the American people about glaring deficiencies at all levels of our food safety network. Today, we're going to examine two of the nation's largest egg producers, Wright County Egg and Hillendale Farms of Iowa. They've been asked to appear today because of evidence that they produced eggs in filthy conditions that caused food poisoning in thousands of consumers across the country. The DeCoster family, which owns Wright County Egg and raised eggs for Hillendale Farms in Iowa, has known about safety problems at these facilities for decades, yet they continue to persist. Over 30 years ago, eggs from a farm operated by the DeCoster family killed 9 people and sickened 500 in New York. 20 years ago, Maryland ordered the DeCosters to stop selling eggs in the state because of the contamination problem. As the committee revealed last week, environmental testing at DeCoster facilities over the last 3 years tested positive dozens of times for potential contamination by a dangerous form of Salmonella. Yet despite these warnings, the DeCoster facilities were operated with a shocking level of disregard for basic food safety controls. Food safety inspectors from FDA finally went inside the facilities in August. And as a photograph I'd like to have displayed shows, they saw decaying corpses of rodents. They also saw unsealed rodent holes along the walls of a hen house. Conditions were so bad in one facility that the wall of the barn was bursting open but because of the excessive manure. DeCoster Farms have had warning after warning, yet they continue to raise chickens in slovenly conditions and to make millions of dollars by selling contaminated eggs. The risks are real. Our first two witnesses today are Ms. Sarah Lewis and Ms. Carol Lobato. Ms. Lewis ate contaminated eggs while celebrating her sister's college graduation. Ms. Lobato was sickened when she went out to dinner with her grandson. They were both hospitalized and gravely ill, and I commend both of them for their courage in speaking out today and being with us at this hearing. Unfortunately, their horrific experiences were shared by many others. The eggs that are the subject of today's hearing sickened over 1,600 people in 11 states. This hearing will make abundantly clear that our food safety laws need a thorough overhaul. Under the leadership of our Chairman Emeritus John Dingell, the committee and the House passed a bipartisan bill last year that would protect consumers from these abuses. The House bill would require farms to report to FDA when they find their unsafe food has entered the food supply. It would give the FDA the clear authority to access records on egg farms during investigations. It would empower the FDA to mandate recalls when firms do not comply voluntarily. These are the kinds of tools that will ensure the safety of the food we consume. Yet, as we hold this hearing today, one senator, a lone senator, Tom Coburn, is holding this vital safety legislation hostage in the Senate. His actions are preventing the FDA from strengthening its oversight and enforcement programs In fact, they're preventing the Senate of the United States from debating the issue, offering amendments, and making decisions about the legislation. And I have a plea for Senator Coburn. For the sake of Ms. Lewis, Ms. Lobato, and hundreds of thousands of Americans who are poisoned by Salmonella every year, please lift your hold and allow this vital safety legislation to move forward. We're going to have some tough questions today for Jack DeCoster, the CEO of the Wright County Egg, and Orland Bethel, the CEO of Hillendale Farms. But I do want to thank them for appearing here voluntarily and for cooperating with today with our committee's investigation. I also want to thank FDA Deputy Commissioner Dr. Joshua Sharfstein for testifying before us today. Our goal is to make American families safer. That's why this hearing is so important and why we must reform our food safety system so that we can eradicate or at least reduce foodborne illnesses. Imagine the FDA cannot get information from these farms. They don't have the ability to subpoena it. They have to be given to them voluntarily. They can't issue a warrant. They have to issue a warrant to get information. There's no obligation by these farms to report to the FDA, even when they know there's a food safety problems. This is unthinkable. That's why the House unanimously, this committee unanimously approved the bill, and the House overwhelmingly adopted it. And now we want the Senate to act. Let's don't go home from Congress without passing food safety legislation. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Waxman. Mr. Latta for opening statement, please, 3 minutes.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Ranking Member Burgess, thank you for holding this subcommittee hearing on the outbreak of the Salmonella in eggs, as the incidence of contaminated food products are a serious concern for our public health. I'm very glad that the two witnesses on our first panel who were affected by these eggs are here today and are on the road to recovery and able to be with us. This hearing is also of great concern to me because egg production is critical to my state, Ohio, which is the second largest egg producing state in the nation. I know many of you have heard me in the past say that I represent the largest manufacturing district in Ohio, but at the same time, I also represent the largest agricultural district in the state of Ohio. And in that those numbers, I also am home to one of two of the top egg-producing counties in the nation. When you look at 465.5 million eggs being produced in my district, that has an economic impact of $102.4 million. Ohio is also one of the 10 states with an egg quality assurance program with the aim to minimize salmonella in eggs. First of all, I think it is important that we remember that the purpose of this hearing is to get the facts. While we have the FDA Form 483 with its general observations about the conditions at the Wright County Egg and the Hillendale Farms operations in Iowa that are being investigated, we do not have the Establishment Inspection Report, which will provide more clear answers. Furthermore, I'm disappointed that the FDA Commissioner is not here to testify, nor is a representative from the USDA. We need to get these answers and hear what went wrong from these producers so that the industry can learn from this recall. We do not want the public to lose confidence in our egg producers. Several of the egg producers in my district are fourth-generation farmers and have been committed to producing a safe, healthy product for years. If we have overburdening regulations that are placed out there, many of these farmers may be forced out of business, unfortunately preventing a fifth generation from being able to farm. The safety and security of our nation's food supply is of the utmost importance to me. Mr. Chairman, I want to thank you very much for the opportunity, and I look forward to hearing the testimony from our witnesses on the panel today. And Mr. Chairman, if I may, I'd also like to submit for the record from the Ohio Poultry Association a document on egg facts in Ohio.
Without objection, that will be made part of your opening statement. We'll receive the document.
Thank you, and I yield back.
Thank you. Mr. Braley from Iowa for opening statement, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Some of my earliest memories are walking into my grandparents' hen houses in Iowa to gather eggs. There was something almost spiritual about this daily routine act. Growing up in Iowa, you couldn't avoid commercials promoting the incredible edible egg. Eggs were a staple in our diet. We ate them fried, poached, hard-boiled, soft-boiled, over-easy, over-hard, sunny-side-up, scrambled in omelets, and that was just for breakfast. We truly believed that eggs were nature's most nearly perfect food. Growing up in Iowa, I don't remember my mother buying eggs in a supermarket. We drove out to the country and we bought them right off the farm from the mothers of the kids we went to school with. We dyed them at Easter and we threw them on Halloween, and we never, ever imagined that they could cause life-threatening illness and kill us. That's why the recent revelations of an incomprehensible half-billion egg recall originating in my home state was so disturbing. So why are we here? First and foremost, we need to examine how and why this happened to ensure the safety of American families and prevent this type of tragedy from happening in the future. Second, we need to identify and eliminate weaknesses in our state and federal food safety enforcement system and take strong measures to hold wrongdoers accountable and protect the good reputations of producers who consistently play by the rules and supply safe food that is at a high quality and a reasonable price. The economic impact of egg producers in Iowa is indisputable. Iowa is America's number one egg producer by a country mile, yet economic impact is no trump card when lives are at stake. Like many Americans, I'm disturbed by the increasing number of foodborne illnesses in the United States. These incidents all raise important questions about the safety and security of our nation's food supply. As an Iowan, I'm offended that some in the egg industry are suggesting that consumers are somehow responsible for getting sick because they didn't properly cook their eggs. Now is the time for accountability, not blame shifting. As an Iowan, I was disgusted to read reports about federal investigators finding live mice, infestations of flies, mountains of manure, and other unsanitary conditions in Iowa hen houses linked to the largest Salmonella outbreak of its kind in the United States. It's clear that changes need to be made to our food system to provide assurances to parents that the food they feed to their families is safe. The House passed food safety legislation last year. You've heard about it. It would give the FDA authority to order mandatory food recalls, impose fines for food safety violations, and require more frequent food facility inspections. It would also give the FDA access to company records in the case of an emergency. These are important first steps to make sure our food supply is safe. We need to be doing a much better job of protecting American families from unsafe food. Every 4 years, Mr. Chairman, people come to my state for the presidential caucuses and see our magnificent gold-domed Capitol. Yet few people take the time to go inside and look up at the rotunda where our ancestors put the wisdom of the ages. My favorite saying in that rotunda is from the Greek lawmaker Solon, who said, "The ideal state, that in which an injury done to the least of its citizens is an injury done to all." Until we get serious about uniform federal food safety practices in this country, we are far from becoming that ideal state. And until consumers feel as safe and secure buying eggs in their neighborhood supermarket as I felt in my grandparents' hen house, egg producers in Iowa and across the country have their work cut out for them. I yield back.
Thank you for your opening statement, but do you want on the record you threw eggs at Halloween? Ms. DeGette, opening statement, please.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I want to add the Chairman's thanks to you for all of these hearings over the last number of years, the 13 hearings. I think I've been sitting with you, Mr. Chairman, for every single one of those hearings. Everything from spinach to peanut butter to jalapeno peppers to meat to nuts. Pretty much the entire American diet has been under scrutiny the last few years. And I just have one question. And the question that I have is, when is the Senate going to pass the very fine food safety bill that this House passed over a year ago? I don't think it's any excuse that one senator can hold up the bill, but if that is the excuse, then I would add to Chairman Waxman's demand that Senator Coburn release his hold on this bill. But beyond that, I think the Senate should stay in session until they pass this bill. The reason is, if we don't, we're going to be sitting here every 6 months, just like we have been for the last 4 years. And the problem with that, it's not just about us passing the legislation. It's about people like the witnesses who are sitting here today, Ms. Lewis and Mrs. Lobato. And, you know, I want to welcome all of you and say how glad I am that you're putting a human face on this again. I particularly have to welcome the Lobatos because they've been family friends of my family's, Mr. Chairman, for many, many years. We won't say how long because then we'll have to reveal our ages. But thank you for coming to talk to us about what's going on here. You know, we can fix this problem. This egg outbreak, which is outrageous, could have been minimized. I mean, aside from the conditions at the hen houses and everything else, if this bill had been law, several things in this legislation could have mitigated this problem. It took 3 months before this voluntary recall, and there were thousands of Americans that fell ill before we determined what the source of contamination was. There are three components to the legislation that this committee and the House passed that are now in the Senate bill that would have prevented this. Number one, under our legislation, the FDA would be able to get the records to show where the contamination came from. Number two, traceability. This was a provision that I worked to get into the legislation, which would allow contaminated products to be quickly traced from the field, or in this case, the hen house, to the fork. And that would greatly decrease the amount of time it would have taken for us to identify the source of the contamination. And the third thing is, the FDA would have now mandatory recall authority. So if the producers themselves didn't recall the product, then the FDA could have. All of these things together would have applied in this situation if this bill had become law. And so frankly, Mr. Chairman, we can't wait till after the election. We can't wait till the next Congress starts. We need to make this bill law now. And I would urge every single person who's here or who's watching this to call their senators and urge them to enact this law before we leave.
Gentlelady yields back. Mr. Doyle for an opening statement, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'll be brief. I want to thank you for holding this hearing and also to say what a pleasure it's been to serve with you on this panel over the years. We're going to miss your presence next year. My thanks also go out to all the witnesses for agreeing to be here to testify, especially our first panel, Ms. Lewis and Ms. Lobato. You know, I remember growing up and learning from my mom how to properly cook eggs because you never knew if the heartbreak of salmonella was just around the corner, and it took me years before I found out that salmonella weren't actually people in the eggs. But even though salmonella has always been a risk when dealing with eggs and poultry, and even though consumers know they have to cook them the right way, people have a reasonable expectation that egg producers are doing all they can to identify and fix issues in production that could cause their hens to get salmonella and pass it on to the eggs. And it looks like it didn't happen here. So I look forward to learning why. Why did companies with a record of prior violations not ensure their facilities were clean and free of rodents? Why did positive tests for salmonella not cause the producers to go into overdrive to clean up their premises? Why did those eggs go to market, into restaurants, into consumers' homes, where they could make so many people sick? You know, it's a blessing that there are no reported deaths from these cases, so I hope we can learn enough today to make sure there isn't a next time. Because next time we might not be so lucky. So I look forward to hearing from our witnesses today. And with that, Mr. Chairman, I'll yield back.
Thank you, Mr. Doyle. Mr. Christensen, for an opening statement, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Here we go again, unfortunately, at another hearing on food contamination. But thank you, Chairman Stupak and Ranking Member Burgess, for your quick response in holding today's hearing on the recent outbreak in salmonella in eggs, which highlights yet another crack in our country's food safety system. In late August, the Food and Drug Administration officials reported that they found positive samples of salmonella that linked two farms into a massive egg recall. Investigators reportedly found salmonella in chicken feed sent to both Wright County Egg and Hillendale Farms. More than 550 million eggs from the two farms were recalled in August after they were linked to as many as 1,300 cases of salmonella poisoning. And I want to also join my colleagues in thanking those, some of those who were harmed by this outbreak for being here today to testify. FDA indicated that contaminated feed was a source of the outbreak, but possibly not the only source. Subsequent on-site inspections revealed grossly unsanitary conditions. A common thread in the numerous hearings we've held on food safety or the lack thereof is the inadequate and fragmented regulation of food in this country. As in this case, there's often a long history of non-compliance with safety and sanitation measures resulting in problems. Wright County Farms, the company involved in this outbreak, has been associated with outbreaks since the early 80s. In the case of eggs, the Ag Department oversees chickens and grades eggs for their quality. The FDA is responsible for the safety of eggs in their shelves. FDA inspects farms after an outbreak of egg-borne disease has been detected, not before. This is just another example of the bureaucratic gaps in regulating food safety that continue to put consumers at risk. As you've heard, last year the House passed H.R. 2749, the Food Safety Enhancement Act, in response to our nation's food safety, what we consider a crisis. But it remains stalled in the Senate. Among other regulatory changes, this bill would give the FDA the power of mandatory recall of diseased food, as well as oversight and access to the safety plans that food service facilities establish, as well as the tests that are conducted to measure safety and inspection records. Until these new regulations are in place, we will not be able to strengthen the food safety oversight. And I do realize that FDA did put some new regulations in place a little too late to really stop this outbreak, but I hope today's hearing will further emphasize the need for the Senate to pass this bill. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back. Thank
you. Mr. Markey, for opening statement, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for holding this hearing. Thanks to Chairman Waxman for his leadership in bringing this issue out into the open, and to our witnesses, we wish you all a full and speedy recovery from this debilitating and life-threatening experience. We can all easily agree that Americans should be able to have their eggs over easy without having to worry that the eggs will make them queasy. But more than 1,000 people have been severely sickened by eggs laced with salmonella since the eggs first entered the food chain in May. More than 500 million eggs have been voluntarily recalled since August. As we have learned, the conditions found in the facilities connected to these eggs were horrific, like something out of Upton Sinclair's The Jungle. It is my fear that this recall may not be the end of the story. There are many egg-producing facilities in other states with strong corporate ties to the companies responsible for the Iowa recall that have not yet been inspected by the FDA. And with Senator Tom Coburn's recent announcement of opposition to the Senate Food Safety Bill, the FDA may well continue to be denied the strong enforcement tools it needs to crack down on unsafe practices that the House passed last year, leaving the corporate fox in charge of the hen house indefinitely. I know that Senator Coburn is a Republican. I know the Republicans in the Senate are trying to stop any legislation from passing. This is a public health imperative. There must be some exception for Republicans in the Senate when it goes to the health of millions of Americans. They must release this bill so we can protect millions of families. This past July, the FDA's new egg rule went into effect, imposing additional safety requirements on large egg producers and ensuring that there will be more FDA inspections at the facilities. So the jury is still out as to whether the Iowa facilities implicated in this infestation represent just a few rotten eggs or whether the safety of this country's egg supply is more like Humpty Dumpty, shattered and in need of full-scale reconstruction. According to reports, companies owned or operated by one of our witnesses today have a decades-long record of public health, labor, and environmental offenses. The Koster egg and feed facilities in Maine and other states have a long history of being found to be responsible for salmonella infections, dumping piles of dead chickens above ground
animal cruelty, worker safety violations, and other problems. Instead of walking on eggshells to comply with state and federal regulations, the hard-boiled corporate executives in Iowa kept facilities that from inspections that showed that ultimately they were overflowing with manure and infested by rodents and flies. My home state of Massachusetts gets many of its eggs from the Maine facilities owned, operated, or otherwise tied to Mr. DeCosta. It's going to be important for us in Massachusetts, in New England, to know whether or not we are at threat as well. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for having this hearing.
Thank you, Mr. Markey. That concludes.
Mr. Chairman, may I ask for a moment for a unanimous consent request?
You can ask. I'm not sure it's going to be given, but
like unanimous consent to insert a statement of the record from Dr. Tom Coburn, and that he is not blocking this bill. Okay. And Senator Reid, who has failed to bring this bill to the floor. Senator Reid's comments that Senator Coburn is blocking the bill are false, and Mr. Reid knows they are false.
All right.
And that needs to be entered in the record.
I object, and I don't believe that that's an accurate statement, so I would object to going into the record.
Okay. There's objection. Will not be made part of record. If you want to submit something later, Mr. Burgess, to supplement your testimony, I'm sure we can work with it, but right now nothing's going to be entered in record. Okay? All right. That concludes the opening statement by members of the subcommittee. I want to call our first panel of witnesses. Our first panel we have first is Ms. Sarah Lewis from Freedom, California, and Ms. Carol Lobato from Littleton, Colorado. I'd ask you please come forward. Take a seat at the witness table. It's the policy of this subcommittee to take all testimony under oath. Please be advised that you have a right under the rules of the House to be advised by counsel during the testimony. Do either of you wish to be represented by counsel?
No.
No? Okay. Then I'm going to ask, you both answered no, you do not wish to be represented by counsel. Therefore, I'll ask you to rise and raise your right hand to take the oath. Do you swear or affirm the testimony you're about to give to be the truth, the whole truth, nothing but truth, a matter pending before this committee?
I do.
Let the record reflect that the witnesses replied in the affirmative. They are now under oath. We will look forward to your opening statement. Ms. Lewis, if you don't mind, I'll start with you. If you'd like to pull that mic forward and press the button, a green light should go on. There we go. Ready to go. Thank you. Thank you for being here.
Good afternoon. Thank you, Chairman Stupak, Ranking Member Burgess, and Chairman Waxman, and committee members. I'm honored to be here today and speak to you about my experience with salmonella poisoning that I got from the recent Wright County and Hillendale Farms egg recall. My name is Sarah Lewis. I'm 30 years old. I am a mom, a wife, and a proud daughter of a small business owner that abides by all of our local and state regulations. I have two beautiful daughters, Haley, 7, Kendall, 4. I have a wonderful husband who has served our country proudly as a Marine, Chris Lewis. Not only did this experience affect me, it affected my whole family. My sister Stacy also got salmonella poisoning from the eggs. The night we ate the custard tart was at my sister's graduation banquet. My whole family was there. My mom, my kids, my husband, my mom and dad, my grandma, my sister and her boyfriend. We were all there celebrating this amazing achievement for my sister, not even suspecting that that night would change our lives for a very long time. My sister and I look back at that night and say, what if our grandma or one of my daughters would have eaten that tart that we would have received? They probably would have died. Knowing how sick we were scares the heck out of us now. The night after the college banquet, I started having severe abdominal cramping and overall not feeling well. My husband said, Sarah, go lay down. You're not feeling and looking so hot. During the night, I woke up vomiting and had severe diarrhea so bad, I was so beyond embarrassed to have to even ask my husband for help. My mom, who lives next door, came over and took one look at me and knew something was terribly wrong. And if you know me, all I wanted to do was stay home and try and feel better. The next day, my mom took me to urgent care, where I was told they would give me a shot to help me stop throwing up. And if I was able to keep water down in 20 minutes, I could go home. Well, 21 minutes later, I was being admitted into the hospital for what would turn out to be the first of two long stays. When I was admitted for the first time, I spent 12 hours in the ER, so sick they were scared to move me. They thought they were going to have to do emergency bowel surgery because the CT scan showed bowels that were so inflamed and so sick I was put in ICU. I was so sick and so dehydrated and in so much pain I could not even see straight. While in ICU, I started to develop severe tachycardia and was moved to the critical care heart unit for 3 days. During that time, I had to go through things I never even want to talk about again. I was so mortified. When I was discharged, I was so excited. This meant I'd be able to go to my daughter's preschool graduation that night. This may seem like a very small thing to many of you, but it meant the world to me. And I thought, great, I can start the healing process and get back to being a mom, a wife, and a daughter. Boy, was I wrong. Approximately 2.5 weeks later, still sick as a dog, I called my doctor, and when I got to the office, he took one look at me and told me I was going back into the hospital. And if for one moment you can imagine two little girls' faces when I have to tell them, mommy's going back into the hospital. It was the hardest thing I ever had to do. It was devastating for any 7 or 4 year old kid. When I was readmitted, I was so dehydrated they had to insert a PICC line into my arterial vein in my right bicep. Talk about traumatic. I was so scared. I was about to have a line inserted into my heart. I proceeded to spend 5 more days in the hospital with my girls crying and screaming every time they had to leave me. I truly do not know what I would have done without my family and friends during this time. When I was released for the second time, I was sure I was on the mend. Wrong again. I developed a severe infection called C. difficile colitis from all the antibiotics and from being in the hospital. C. diff causes severe diarrhea and cramping. As though I didn't have this already, I had to be on antibiotics every 6 hours for the next 14 days again. And all during this, I found out that the salmonella was still present and raging in my body. This was just devastating news to my family and myself. I still have severe cramping, diarrhea, fevers, and the stress and fear that the salmonella is present in my body. Every day when I leave to go to work or even just to the grocery store, my youngest daughter looks at me and starts crying. It just breaks my heart. At this whole time, I'm trying to figure out what has caused my salmonella poisoning. Then one morning, my dad's reading the newspaper, and there was an article about my sister Stacy and I that we were part of the egg recall. As I start reading about the egg companies, it causes my stomach to turn. My family owns a retail butcher shop, Freedom Meat Lockers, and as we go through weekly state inspections and quarterly county inspections, we have to maintain and uphold a standard that we are very proud of. We are rated #1 butcher shop in all of California for cleanliness and sanitation. To think that my sister and I got sick from a company that does not care about their regulations and quality is beyond appalling to me and my family. I do not come to you today just for me and my sister. I come for every man, woman, and child who's gotten sickened by Wright County Eggs and other producers who did not consider the repercussions of their actions. I wish I could say this would never happen again. Please consider changing your FDA policies to more closely monitor the egg industry. Thank you for your time and listening to my story. Sarah Lewis.
Thank you, Ms. Lewis. Ms. Lobato, your testimony, please. I'm going to ask you to turn on that mic and pull it a little closer to your person there.
Good morning, Chairman Waxman, Chairman Stupak.
May I have you pull that mic up just
and
a little bit more?
And members of the committee. Thank you for inviting me to Washington to share my story. I hope that by doing so, together we can make our dinner tables and our entire food system safer for all of us. My name is Carol Lobato. I live in Littleton, Colorado. I'm 77 years old, and today have been married to my husband for 54 years. We are retired and blessed with 4 children and grandchildren. Ed is a World War II veteran and was awarded the Bronze Star and Purple Heart for his services in Okinawa. My story began the evening of July 10th of this year, the night that Ed and I took our grandson, Drew, to the Fort Restaurant in Morrison, Colorado. The Ford is an upscale restaurant that serves wild game and other exotic dishes. The Fort was the restaurant that hosted President Clinton and the other world leaders for the Summit of the Eight dinner in 1997. One of the items that we ordered that night was an appetizer of rattlesnake cake. All of us tasted the dish, and none of us particularly liked it. The next afternoon, I felt very sick. At the beginning, I started to shake and experienced chills. Then came waves of vomiting and explosive diarrhea. My fever rose to 102. Later, the doctors called this septic shock. Ed rushed me to the emergency room. Their doctors administered several tests, including chest x-rays, CAT scan, blood, stool, and urine samples. They gave me IV hydration and sent me home after several hours and told me to return if the symptoms did not improve. The next day, I went to see our family doctor as I was experiencing diarrhea, stomach cramps, dizziness, and weakness. He examined me and sent me to Swedish Hospital in Englewood. The ride to the hospital was very unpleasant. I was quite sick. My electrodes were depleted, my potassium level was dangerously low, and the doctors at the hospital immediately put me on IVs of antibiotics, potassium, and I also was on oxygen. A few days later, the cultures come back as positive for Salmonella bacteria that was both in my bloodstream and my intestine. Since I take medication for rheumatoid arthritis, which compromises my immune system, I was particularly at risk for an infectious bacteria like Salmonella. The infection wiped me out to the point where I was unable to function. I could not even get out of bed without help. I remained at the hospital for an agonizing 4 nights, 5 days before I was finally discharged to come home. The Salmonella infection is not over for me. I have lost my stamina. I often experience indigestion, and it is difficult for me to enjoy certain foods. I feel very tired and require rest during the day. I lost 8 pounds in the hospital, which was the only plus of this ordeal. My doctors told me that I almost certainly would have died without aggressive intervention. Ed and Drew, our grandson, were also ill, but their condition was not as serious as mine. The CDC and the Jefferson County Department of Health later determined that the rattlesnake cake that we consumed at the Fort was the source of our illness. Through a traceback procedure, investigators found that the eggs used in the rattlesnake cake had not been properly cooked. They were from the Wright County Egg Farm in Iowa. The Salmonella found in my cultures was the exact DNA match to the Salmonella found in the egg farm. The CDC has recently published reports that at least 1,500 others in the country have also suffered from the identical strain of Salmonella found in the contaminated eggs from the Wright County eggs in the Hillendale farms. The FDA has now inspected the farms and found several violations. The published inspection report shows the following. Chicken manure piles 4 to 8 feet high in the hen houses. Live wild birds, not chickens, flying around the hen houses. Rodent burrows along the baseboard of the hen houses. Liquid manure seeping through the concrete foundation. Standing water in the chicken manure pits. Loose chickens walking through the manure piles and laying their eggs inside. 31 live mice observed in the hen house. Live and dead flies too numerous to count inside the hen houses. 65 unsealed rodent holes in the walls of the hen house. These findings are shocking to me. Not have personal experience. with chickens and eggs. You see, I grew up on an Iowa farm. I was one of five girls, and I shared the responsibility for doing the work and the chores that went with the family farm. That included raising chickens from little chicks to the time they were ready for market, and for the eggs that we gathered and sold. Our family, our farm never looked the way these two farms look and have been described. We never had any problems because we kept our farm clean, took proper care of our chickens, and did things the correct way. 3 years ago, this country suffered a horrible salmonella outbreak linked to contaminated peanut butter that sickened over 700 nationwide. Last year, this country was struck by another peanut butter salmonella outbreak that sickened 700, killing 9, tragically. Both times, survivors like me come before this committee asking for help. But this time, I am the one asking for you on behalf of myself and my family and 1,500 others who were sickened. Please make our food supply safer. Pass legislation that provides funding and more inspectors so that these companies keep us safe. Pass legislation that requires testing of products before they leave the factories. Pass legislation that rewards companies who do the right thing and punish those who refuse to do so. Because if we don't, we will all be here again. Thank you. Respectfully, Kara Lobato.
Thank you, and thank you both for your testimony. Thank you for coming here to Washington, D.C., traveling here with your families. And I deeply regret that you've suffered as part of this massive outbreak of salmonella, but your testimony has really helped us, telling members of Congress your story, but also the American people, and it'll help us, and hopefully we can move the legislation. Have you heard so much about this morning, I should say the afternoon. Let me ask you a couple questions, if I may.
Sure.
In the binder in front of you there, there's a tab number 16. Mr. Waxman and I showed photographs that were taken by federal public health officials in the course of their inspections of the egg facilities. And Ms. Lobato, you sort of mentioned them in your testimony as you've had some experience with farms and that. When you look at these photos, what goes through your mind about the conditions of these farms? Ms. Lobato?
Just a deplorable situation here. Phil.
You know, Ms. Lobato, you said in your testimony, you said maybe we should consider rewarding companies for doing things right so we don't have these food outbreaks. Isn't the fact that a consumer would put confidence in, let's say, a Wright farm or Hillendale farm, isn't that enough reward? We shouldn't have to reward people to produce, in this case, eggs in a proper, sanitary, safe condition, should we?
They should be safe.
And
they
without
all
reward.
Be safe.
Okay.
Coming
okay.
from the farm.
Okay. Ms. Lewis, anything you want to add on the photographs or anything?
It's appalling to me. Like I said, my family owns a retail shop, and when I show pictures to people of our facility, they're amazed how clean it is and how we give tours of the whole place, and we're not afraid to show people around. We don't have anything that is appalling as this. And
in your butcher shop, do you have to? You have a plan to take care of pests and rodents
Absolutely.
And flies, and
yeah,
you cannot have them around?
Absolutely. We have strict regulations and guidelines that we have to abide by, and we have weekly maintenance services that come out and tend to that, so it has never been a problem. We've never had an infestation of any kind in our facility, and my father, Howard, has owned it since 1970, and he took it over from his dad, and my dad and my mom have always upheld the standards that we are proud of. And like I said, we give customers tours. We will show them our facility. We are not afraid to show what we do to everybody who wants to see it.
Do you find the inspections at your level in your butcher shop overburdensome?
No.
Too much government regulation?
We are state and we are quarterly county inspected.
Okay.
And you know, we don't worry about it. They come in, and the last thing we got written up for was because somebody didn't have a hat on. So, you know, our Our plant is so clean that when they come in, they say it's honestly a pleasure to come into our facility, and they actually want people to come to our plant and view our plant and how my dad has everything, tile, stainless steel, and he has everything to a certain standard.
So in areas like food safety, government regulation, in your estimation, as owning a butcher shop is good?
Repeat the question, I'm sorry?
Sure. Government regulation, we hear so much government shouldn't be in our lives, get them out of there, we don't need government regulations. And in your own personal experience, has it been helpful to you and your business?
Absolutely. I feel as though if we did not have regulations on our facility, there's other butcher shops, and if they didn't uphold to a certain standard, then the product that's out there is not going to be of a certain level. And if it's not, then this is what's going to happen. And this is not acceptable.
In all of our hearings we've had, we've always heard it's always young people, older citizens, or people with compromised immune system who are susceptible to food poisoning, whether it's E. coli or Salmonella or Listeria. You don't seem to fit anyone in those categories.
I actually do have a compromised immune system. I have asthma, and I've been on steroids on and off for a long period of time due to my asthma and my lungs. And so they figured that due to my compromised immune system, that's why it hit me so hard. And, you know, I actually had heart surgery when I was 18. So I have a long history of health trouble. And so when this came into my system, it just overpowered my whole system and it took over. And I'm still not feeling well. And to think that anybody has to go through this is sickening.
Are you off your medication now?
No, I laugh. I have a little old lady box of medicine that I take every day. And I don't have a choice. You know, I'm on 5 to 10 different medications and I've lost 30 pounds. And my sick joke is, okay, you can cure my salmonella in 30 more pounds. You know what I mean? But, you know, it's not funny. And it's I don't want to be on all these medications to try and keep my immune system up, you know? It's not acceptable for supposedly someone who's young and 30 and healthy. It's not okay.
Ms. Lovato, you've completely recovered now from your experience?
I can't say that, no.
Okay.
There's a lot of things I can't eat that just are really hard to digest and give you a lot of heartburn and upset stomach and so forth. So.
Well, we're glad you're still here. Glad you had your 54th wedding anniversary and celebrating it with us. And Ed, thank you for your service to our country. And with that, let me yield to Mr. Burgess for questions, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And thanks to both of you for sharing what are very compelling stories with us. And if you heard in my opening statement, I referenced some of the surveillance cultures that were done at the egg farm, 72 swabs and only 8 were negative for Salmonella. Now, obviously, to me at least, when I too spent time on a farm as a youngster and my family was involved in the meat business on my mother's side, I would think that's an outlier. We'll get a chance to ask the egg manufacturers directly. But when you look at the oversight, now, Ms. Lewis, you suggested that there's several places that regulate you, but you said those are state and county?
Yes.
So no USDA, no FDA coming into your shop?
We are not a federally regulated plant. We're a state regulated plant. And so the meat that does come into us is USDA inspected.
Okay.
Absolutely.
But just the notion that you would have that many positive tests and no surveillance by the federal agency responsible for ascertaining egg safety, I mean, that seems a little bit large, does it not?
Absolutely. If they're supposed to be a federal agent, you know, on premises at all times, that's his job, as well as the owners, to make sure and to uphold those standards. And he's supposed to be walking around and checking everything, and that's why he's there. That's why they are a federal regulated plant. There's reasons why you have a federal agent in your building mandating it. There's reasons, and obviously those reasons were not met.
And Ms. Lovato, your experience with the egg business, when you had opportunities to observe it up close and personal, you never saw anything like we were these astonishing photographs that were
not
shared with
all.
Us
not
this morning.
All.
And that's sort of my recollection as well, though I will confess to you, I've never spent time on a commercial farm, so I don't know, you know, the context in which to place these photographs.
Our chickens would be what would be called free range now. They walked everywhere.
and I promise you, I am only buying free-range eggs from this point on after seeing those photographs. They're fairly dramatic. Now, Ms. Lewis, you said you became sick in the early part of July. The recall started August 13th. Do I have the time frame correct there?
The banquet was Saturday, May 29th.
Oh, so you were ill in May. And then, Ms. Labata, your exposure was later?
July 10th.
You know, unfortunately, when you look at some of these things and the recalls, we did tomatoes a couple of years ago, also with salmonella, it does take time. To either of you, does that seem unreasonable, that time span from May 27th to August 13th or July 2nd to August 13th when the recall was affected? Does that seem like an unreasonable period of time? Tough question to ask you because you both suffered with the consequences.
From my point of view, you know, when you're eating a dinner at a banquet, you have 10 different things on your plate, from butter, you know, to chicken, to different things. And then on your salad, you as well have several different things. So you have to try and figure out if it came from what's on your dinner plate, your salad plate, your appetizer. So, yeah, I do think that it would take time to try and pinpoint where it came from.
When were you questioned in the sequence of this about the source of your illness? Or did it just come up from the DNA testing?
It came up from the DNA testing, and I read a newspaper article. And then I called the
So you sought them out rather than
Yeah, I did. I had to call the county nurse and be like, is this me in the newspaper article and my sister? Is this, you know, am I that person? And she's like, and I said, am I? And she said, yeah. And that's how I found out. I had to seek out the information.
Okay. Well, I want to thank both of you for being here with us. And Ms. Lewis, I'll just tell you from the perspective of a former practicing physician, the Clostridium difficile complication that you suffered, one of the most fearsome things you can undergo as a consequence of antibiotic therapy. I mean, certainly had patients with that during my professional lifetime, and it in and of itself is an ordeal and a memorable one. Mr. Chairman, just before I yield back, and again, thanks to our witnesses, before I yield back the balance of my time, I do want to read Dr. Coburn's statement. If Majority Leader Reid believes this legislation
right
is
now,
a matter of life and death, I still have control.
Statement.
I still control the time, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Burgess,
if Majority
you've
Leader
been directed
Reid
that
believes
the statement would
this
not.
Legislation is a matter of life and death, he
Mr.
should bring
Burgess,
it to the floor
I'd
immediately
ask you to cease. Your
for
time
a
is
full
expired.
And open debate. As Majority Leader, he sets the schedule. I do not. It is false. Mr. Chairman, I just have to say, I do not recall, this is a bipartisan issue. I voted with you on the dang bill. I worked with you on the dang bill. Now, it is preposterous that you have conducted, or that the majority has conducted the hearing in this fashion. We have to sit here and listen to a member of the Senate be excoriated by members of your side when he's not the problem. Yeah, he may become a problem if Senator Reid brings it to the floor, but if Senator Reid doesn't bring it to the floor, he's not the problem. So, again, I just
Mr. Burgess.
Don't understand why you would turn what is a bipartisan effort into such a partisan excoriated affair.
Mr. Burgess, legislation come out of this committee because of the work of many people on this committee, the full committee, Democrats and Republicans, is bipartisan. And we passed that bill July of 2009 after 3 years of work by this committee. And, yeah, we're a little frustrated that the Senate, one person, can put a hold on a bill.
That is Senator Reid, just for
one
the record.
One person can put a
Senator
hold on
the Reid,
bill,
the majority leader
and our
the
legislation
Senate.
Does not move. So, if you have a beef, take it up with Senator Colburn. Maybe we can move our legislation. And with that, let me turn it to Mr. Braley for questions, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And Ms. Labato, I'm very pleased to hear that you had a lovely childhood growing up in Iowa. Did any of the comments I made in my opening statement ring true with you?
Absolutely.
Now, one of the things that struck me about both of your testimony was that neither one of you prepared the food that made you sick.
That's right.
And that illustrates one of the challenges we have been trying to face on this committee, which is we have a hodgepodge of state and federal food safety regulations that impose different requirements on different egg producers depending upon where their facilities are located. We're making some strides based upon the recent regulation that the FDA passed regulating egg production facilities, but both of you are the living examples of how consumers are at risk through no fault of their own because of cooking techniques that they have no control over. Now, one of the things I want to talk to you about is the mandatory recall authority, because as you heard, our committee began pushing for reform of the food safety system for years, and as you heard, this is the 13th hearing this subcommittee has conducted on food safety in the last 4 years. Our committee authored and successfully passed H.R. 2749, the Food Safety Enhancement Act, and included in that legislation is a provision that would give the FDA much-needed increased authority to issue mandatory recalls of tainted food products. And I'm going to ask both of you, would it surprise you to learn that the FDA currently lacks the authority to issue a mandatory recall?
That's surprising.
Yeah. And while the two Iowa farms in question did issue voluntary recalls, do you two believe that FDA should have to rely upon the company's goodwill to do that when the public's health is at risk?
No.
Now, one of the things that we know is that the legislation like the House bill that we've been talking about would give the Food and Drug Administration the power to require the recall of a contaminated food that is needed. Do you think that would be a good idea for food safety for consumers in this country?
Be a start.
Now, Ms. Lewis, you spent a lot of time talking about the incredible impact that your illness from this salmonella contamination had on your quality of life.
Oh, absolutely.
And I think there's this great misperception in the public that these symptoms that people deal with from salmonella contamination are like a minor case of intestinal flu.
No, it was so severe. I didn't even want to leave my house. I didn't even want to go to work. And I work right across the street. I didn't want to take my kids to school. You don't even, to be blunt, you don't even want to sneeze or cough. It's miserable. Life as you know it completely changes.
And you don't even want to move.
Oh, you can't move because you're in such physical pain from the stomach cramps. And you have like your whole body, head to toe, is in agony. I was in fetal position for I don't even know how long. I couldn't even move.
You also talked about the need to insert something called a PICC line into your bicep. Can you just tell us a little bit more about what that was and what it was designed to do?
Yeah, absolutely. I was so dehydrated that they could not find a vein to insert an IV in, and they needed to get IVs or antibiotics, steroids, and fluid into me as quickly as they could. And my doctor suggested a PICC line, and it goes right here in your arm. And once it goes in, they do an x-ray to make sure that the line is actually properly inserted into your heart. And, you know, to my knowledge, once it goes in, it's a pretty permanent port. And I have scars from it, and I'll always have those scars. But it was something that I had to do, but otherwise I would not be able to have the medication I needed.
And Ms. Lobato, I'm going to give you the chance to make the same type of a comment. What was this like for you on a daily basis to deal with the symptoms from your salmonella contamination?
Well, you're just so severely sick. And as Sarah said, you really can't go very far from the bathroom. And you're so tired. You're so fatigued, worn out. You see the bed and you just want to flop in it. And another end result is that you have a hard time trusting food.
Let's talk about that briefly. Do you remember ever having a duck egg, Ms. Lobato?
A duck egg? No, I don't think so.
That's what's amazing is that in the 1920s and 30s, duck eggs were more popular for consumers than chicken eggs. And it was a result of a salmonella problem with those eggs that they basically disappeared from the American table. And as a result of those problems, There were many food safety bills that were passed to address the problem and try to protect consumers. We need to bring that same level of focus in 2010 and protect consumers from these foodborne illnesses, and thank you both for your testimony.
Thank you. Thank you.
Mr. Hilato for questions, please.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. And again, ladies, thanks very much for being with us today. And having been one that has had food poisoning twice, you know, a lot of us go to a lot of events, and you eat what they put out in front of you. And I can commiserate with you on what happened to you, because I know for 2 to 3 days, in my case, I know I was down. And you're absolutely right. You don't want to get too far from home. So, I can really empathize with you on that. And, you know, Mrs. Lobato, your background sounds like my mother's. She grew up on a 100-acre farm in Ohio, and they had cows and some pigs and chickens. And my mom, to this day, still likes brown eggs the best. And But it's one of those things that our agriculture's kind of changed through the years. But, I've got to ask this question of both of you, because in reading your testimony and hearing you talk about it, as has been brought up about that you didn't prepare the food, I've got to ask you this. What is rattlesnake cake, and how is that prepared? Is that something that's, is it raw? Is it baked, fried? How is that prepared?
This is kind of a bit of an exotic restaurant. It's built like a fort, mm-hmm. and they specialize in meats of, well, supposedly the 1800s, early 1900s, and they have elk and buffalo and bison and all kinds of things. But one of the appetizers is rattlesnake cake, and it comes like a little, like a crab cake, small. And they apparently boil the rattlesnake for 6 hours or something. Then they grind it up, and it's with breadcrumbs and egg and spices hold it all together. And it just comes on a little plate as an appetizer, and had some green sauce on the top of it, a relish, garnish. And I understand that that's where the raw egg was, or the uncooked egg, was in
right.
the relish that was on the top.
So it wasn't the breading that was holding the whole thing together?
I don't believe so. I'm not sure okay. that that's been determined at this okay. point.
Thank you.
But I just wanted to say our farm was not a chicken farm, yeah. per se. We had all kinds of
right.
animals, pigs and chickens.
Yeah, as I said, it sounded like where my mom grew up. And Mrs. Lewis, and with a custard tart, is that, and you know, my wife's not here to help me out on these things. Is that something that's baked, or what is that raw? Is there something raw in there, or how's that prepared, do you know?
Well, from what I was told, it's like a cheesecake base. And the bakery that made it, they always use a pasteurized egg solution. And that day, they happened to run out of that and started using whole eggs. And so that's where the salmonella came from, was the whole eggs. So, but to my knowledge, it is like a baked kind of dessert. And then to a certain point, so it still tastes like a custard.
Well, thank you very much. And Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Thank you, Mr. Latta. Mr. Gett for questions, please.
Thanks, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Latta, this restaurant, the fort, is actually a fort that's been around for many, many years. And as Ms. Lobato pointed out, this was a restaurant where they even had a big event when the G8 came to Denver some years ago. And so what I think Ms. Lobato is trying to say is this kind of contamination can happen anywhere, even at the very nicest restaurants or just little places, and that's what concerns all of us. I want to ask both of you, Ms. Lobato, the food you ate was in, I think, July 11th, around the first part of July, correct?
I can.
And Ms. Lewis, the food that you ate was in at the end of May,
that's correct.
Mm-hmm. So that was maybe 6 weeks apart, between the two of you when you had those. Do you think that that's, and of course the recall didn't happen until late August. Mm-hmm. So do you think that's an unreasonable amount of time to identify the source of the contamination and to get these products off the shelves?
Well, you know, it's funny. My sister Stacy and I were number one and number two case in Salmonella in all of California. And so for her and I to be the first and second, you know, to me, it seems like a long time. But to the person who's number 500, it happened maybe a couple weeks later when they found out, you know. So being the first and second person, of course, it's going to seem like a longer period of time than it would to somebody who got sick later.
But what I'm saying is, what you described was the bakery that made those tarts had used a different kind of egg solution that day. So theoretically, it wouldn't have been that hard to figure out that was different, and then to look where those eggs came from and trace it back to the farm in Iowa, right?
True. But like as I said before, there's also 10 things on my plate for dinner.
Sure.
There's 10 things in my salad. There's, you know, there's an appetizer. So, in fact, did it come from X, Y, or Z? It's hard to tell at that time until you start actually pulling out everything and researching it. So as they start researching it, then I do feel, you know what I mean, that it was done appropriately. But
yeah.
You can't tell if it's this or this because there's so many different components to what you receive at a banquet.
Well, would you be surprised to know we actually can tell if it's this or this? And if you have a traceability system, you actually can trace it quickly. Part of the problem we have now is that the Food and Drug Administration, as you told Mr. Braley, they don't have mandatory recall authority, okay. And we don't have traceability, so it is harder to figure out where the components come from. But technologically, we have the ability throughout our food industry to be able to trace where things came from. So if they had taken all of the components on your plate and they had been able to trace them back,
yeah.
It would have moved much more quickly. Does that make sense to
that
you?
That seems appropriate, yes.
Yeah. And did anybody else from that graduation party get sick besides you and your sister?
There was, to my knowledge, another gentleman that got sick as well. We were at the graduation banquet, and then the next night was a prom. And people from that prom
also,
got
sick.
Yeah.
So you know, you had a group of people that got sick. We saw this with some of the other outbreaks as well, the peanut butter and other ones, where lots of people were getting sick. And when you see a big group like that getting sick, it's something that the state health officials really pay attention
absolutely.
To.
Absolutely.
And Ms. Lobato, did you want to add to that?
Well, I just wanted to say that the Department of Health for Jefferson County and for Denver were on my case while I was in the hospital.
Mm-hmm.
They called 3 days in and wanted to know what I had eaten at the restaurant, what I had eaten for a week before. So I was very impressed at how fast they were on the situation.
Right. It's, you know, what we've been finding the last few years with these foodborne illness outbreaks, oftentimes it's the public health officials who identify it. They're the first ones. But because we don't have a modern food safety and tracing system, it takes many weeks mm-hmm. to then track down where that came from. So if you had the components of our legislation that we passed in a sometimes you hear us sniping up here, but you know, we actually passed this bill in a bipartisan way through the House. And if you had that in place, once those state officials identified what it was, it would be a lot easier than to trace it back to its source, and it would eliminate many new cases of the illness because you could get the recall going much more quickly.
Right.
Thank you. Thank you both for coming again.
Thank you.
Mr. Doyle, for questions, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Ms. Lewis, thank you for your testimony, and Ms. Lobato, happy anniversary, and thank you. You know, I appreciate the fact that you come here today because it's important we put a face on these problems. The chairman said earlier, people talk all the time about all this government regulation and let's get the government off our backs and, you know, no more regulation. Like we sit here every day thinking of ways to harass businesses and make them lose money and go out of business. But the reality is the fact that most Americans can take for granted that when they turn their water spigot on, the water they drink isn't going to poison them, or the food they eat is going to be safe, or the air they breathe in their neighborhood isn't going to cause them grave harm. A lot of it is due to the fact that things like this happened. And one of the ways we address that is to come up with regulations to make sure that when food's being produced, it's done in a certain way. There's standards in place. The same with how our water is treated and what you can put into water and what you can put into the air. And, you know, sometimes you can have the best regulations in the world, and if you don't have it enforced, if there's not proper oversight, even good regulations fall short. We saw that in the Gulf of Mexico not too long ago with a terrible oil spill. So I hope Americans see this today. They see two people, and they look at both of you and hear your stories and say, that could be my grandmother, that could be my mom, that could be my sister. And people realize there's a reason for this. And that, yeah, we do need good regulations, and we need good oversight. And when everybody does things the way they're supposed to do it, people can make money and businesses can thrive, and we can all feel good about the fact that what's put on our tables or when we go to a restaurant, that something terrible isn't going to happen to us after we leave that restaurant. And that's really the purpose of the hearing today is to get to the bottom of these things. And I think more than anything we'll hear today, it'll be your personal stories. I think that will touch many of the people in the U.S. Senate and whoever's got that hold over there. You know, the Senate's a strange institution. One of these guys can hold up legislation no matter what it is. I had a bill that passed here this year that a senator had a hold on, so I went over and talked to him, and he lifted his hold, and then another senator put a hold on the bill. So I went over and talked to that senator, and he lifted his hold. Then I was told there's a secret hold on the bill, and now we don't know which senator has a hold on it. So it's a strange institution over there. And sometimes it takes stories like this to move them to action. So thank you for coming today and helping us out and helping your fellow citizens in America have safe food to eat. Mr. Chairman, I'll yield back.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Doyle. Seeing no further members ask questions, I want to thank you again for coming and for helping us out. And I know you came here on your own free will and with your own expense, so we appreciate it. And so on behalf of the Congress, American people, thank you for being here. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Burgess.
I wonder if I might be recognized for the purpose of entering into the colloquy, for a colloquy with the chairman.
Sure, go ahead.
Mr. Chairman, is it not true that under Committee Rule 3, Subsection D, under questioning the right to interrogate a witness before the committee or any of its subcommittees, alternate between the majority and minority members, each member shall be entitled to 5 minutes in interrogation of the witnesses. Is that your understanding of the rule?
To question witnesses, that is correct.
5 minutes of time was to be controlled by the ranking member of the committee, and 30 seconds of that time were taken from me. Could I ask the chairman's indulgence to restore that time on the next panel of witnesses?
No, Mr. Burgess. You were instructed that there was a your unanimous consent was denied, and you tried to violate the wishes of this subcommittee by going back door. You said you were done with your questions. It's not unusual to members to end less than 5 minutes. We yield back our time and move on. But I asked you not to go on, read it. You insisted upon reading it. I let you read until your 5 minutes expired, and then I muted your mic. So you had your 5 minutes. You chose to use your last 30 seconds or whatever to read a statement. So I'm not going to give you more time with the next witness.
Mr. Chairman, with all due respect, you muted my mic immediately upon my beginning to read the statement. And further, in regards to that controlling of 5 minutes, as you know, it's a well-established pattern, especially in this committee, that members may use their time to talk about whatever they wish. Sometimes they offer soliloquies that I think are entirely far afield from where we are, but I don't object to them doing that, and certainly I don't recall anyone ever being treated in the way of having their microphone silenced. I took look upon that as a period of censorship that you exercised, and I've got to tell you, I feel very strongly about this, and I think that was wrong, and I think this committee needs to rectify it.
The record is clear what happened. If we have to read it back later, we can. You had your 5 minutes. Even after the objections of this committee, you decided to go ahead and read a statement, which you asked unanimous consent be submitted to record. The members on our side objected. You should not then, if you wanted to follow the rules of the House, you would not have tried to backdoor it by reading it in.
But
I let you go, excuse me, don't interrupt me. I let you go until your 5 minutes was up. You had your full 5 minutes. And this has happened before. I've been here 18 years. In fact, even up here, the way I could mute your mic is because it says private and it says mute all. This is not the first time it happened, Mike. It's happened many times. You have to go by the rules of this committee and by the ruling of the chair. You cannot take and make your own rules as we go along. You are violating the wishes of the committee. You're violating the rules of this subcommittee. And you're violating the proper decorum as the way we conduct hearings. My job, my responsibility, is to move this hearing forward, conduct it in a fair and impartial manner. I did that.
Mr. Chairman, I would submit that Rule 3, subparagraph D, was violated by the chair and not by the ranking member.
We're not going to agree. So let's move on. Let me call our next panel of witnesses. On our second panel, we have Austin Jack DeCoster, owner of Wright Country Farm, Peter DeCoster, Chief Operating Officer, Wright County Egg, Orland Bethel, President, Hillendale Farm of Iowa, Mr. Dwayne Manskow, Production Manager, Hillendale Farms, Iowa. Just waiting for people to settle down here a little bit. It's the policy of this subcommittee to take all testimony under oath. Please be advised that you have the right under the rules of the House to be advised by counsel during your testimony. Do any of you gentlemen wish to be represented by counsel? Mr. DeCoster, you want to press that button, and I'd ask you just to give us the name of your counsel.
Jan Kramer.
Okay. And during your testimony, before you answer a question, if you'd like to consult with your counsel, you have a right to do so.
Thank you.
Okay. Anyone else?
Yes, John Bodie.
Okay. Mr. Bethel?
Yes.
Press the button there in front of you, sir.
Yes, I have counsel here.
Would you state counsel's name?
Tom Green.
Okay, and again, if you wish to consult with them during questions, you may, but the questions have to come from you, or the answers have to come from you, I'm sorry. And Mr. Manskow?
No.
No counsel with you, okay. All right, so we have that on the record, and again, anytime during the question you wish to consult with your counsel, you may. So I'm going to ask you to please raise your right hand to take the oath. Do you swear or affirm? Mr. Bethel, I'm going to raise your hand. Do you swear or affirm testimony you're about to give to be the truth, the whole truth, nothing but the truth in the matter pending before this committee?
Yes, sir.
Let the record reflect each witness answered in the affirmative. They are now under oath. We will now hear a 5-minute opening statement from our witnesses. You may submit a longer statement for inclusion in the hearing record. So, Mr. DeCoster, on my far left, Jack, if you want to start your opening statement, please do. Press the green light there on that microphone and pull it forward, and we can hear you. Go ahead.
Good. Commissioner, Mr. Chairman, and members of the committee, thank you for the opportunity to testify. My name is Austin DeCoster. I go by Jack. My son, Peter, and I are here to answer your questions.
All right, can we ask the Foster room be cleared?
The Coster and your cohorts are a mere picture of a piece of the larger
present in all egg farms as admitted by the processor and his lawyer. Additionally, 230 million chickens are killed each year to the egg laying industry.
I'll ask that you would cease and desist, please, sir. The hearing must continue.
All eggs killed! 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 All eggs killed!
Right here. Okay.
Okay, we resume these hearings. It's not unusual for us to have a few outbursts, whether it's on this side of the dais or that side. So, Mr. DeCoster, go ahead, please.
Okay. We were horrified to learn that our eggs may have made people sick. We apologize to everyone who may have been sickened by eating our eggs. I have prayed several times each day for all of these people, for improved health. For generations, our family has been producing eggs, and I have spent my life as a chicken farmer. I've been blessed to be able to work with my sons on our farms as well. Over the years, we have grown to be pretty big in producing eggs. Unfortunately, we got big quite a while before we stopped acting like we were small. What I mean by that is we were big before we started adopting sophisticated procedures to be sure we met all of the government requirements. While we were big but still acting like we were small, we got into trouble with government requirements several times. I am sorry for those failings. I accept the responsibility for those mistakes in our operations. Eventually, I realized that to put those problems behind us, we would have to become very good at meeting all the government requirements. So for about 10 years now, we have been focused on doing just that. We are moving forward. We have put in place effective employee training systems, additional monitoring and control procedures to assure compliance with government requirements. When necessary, we hire top experts to be sure the procedures are right. Also, in critical areas, including reduction of Salmonella enteritis, we have been going beyond government requirements in an effort to improve our operations. With all these systems, we have made important strides, and I'm proud of our work. Still, these challenges never stop.
That complete, go ahead. That complete your testimony?
Yes, that completes it.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman, my name is Peter DeCoster. I'm the Chief Operating Officer for Wright County Egg of Galt, Iowa. In other words, I run the Wright County Egg Farms. Permit me to begin with a short overview of Wright County egg farming operation in Iowa. 350 people are employed at our Iowa farms. We have five farms with 73 hen-laying barns, each about 33,000 square feet in size. Almost all of the barns are a two-story structure, with the hens located in the upper part of the barn. In all, Wright County has 5.8 million laying hens. Our farms produce approximately 2.3 million dozen eggs per week, or about 1.4 billion eggs per year. In addition, Wright County Egg operates the barns at the Hillendale Farm near Alden, Iowa, with 10 barns and approximately 1 million laying hens, producing more than 435,000 dozen eggs per week. Each of the six farms we operate is at a different location. No two farms are less than 1 mile from one another. In addition to our farms, at a separate location, Wright County Egg operates a feed mill which produces our poultry feeds. It was inspected by Iowa with no major deficiencies found. The inspection report was transmitted to us by the FDA in May. Some background on the Salmonella enteritis. and how our egg farms are monitored for the bacteria may also be useful. Regrettably, SE is a fact of life in the egg industry. That is why all egg cartons bear the safe food handling instructions and the FDA model code requirements that eggs be thoroughly cooked. Like everyone else who has been producing eggs for decades, we have fought SE for a long time, and we have not always been successful. Today, we have extensive SE reduction practices that were unknown in previous years. To protect against SE contamination, our farm follows stringent standards for egg production, processing, and transportation to ensure both the quality and safety of eggs when they reach our customers. In addition to following food safety guidelines and the new FDA egg safety rules, our farm also established in July of 2009 a voluntary overall salmonella intervention and risk reduction program, which set specific protocols in the areas of chicks and breeder flocks, biosecurity, cleaning and disinfecting between flocks, pest management, vaccination, and refrigeration. Further, Wright County Egg has been working with two top scientists to enhance our biosecurity and bird health needs. They provide outside counsel to design effective programs, monitor their performance, and make operational refinements as necessary. Of particular potential assistance to your investigation, Dr. Charles Hulfaker has advised us on bird health matters. Dr. Hulfaker is recognized as one of the world's leading authorities in SE control, and I appreciate his presence in the hearing room today. As a tool in our SE reduction program, Wright County Egg began SE vaccinations of our flocks. That vaccination program and the voluntary environmental testing program that guided it and other operational decisions is outlined in our written testimony. So we have had extensive SE reduction program designed to meet all regulatory requirements and go substantially beyond the requirements with additional measures, notably our SE vaccination program. So we were stunned to learn that our eggs appeared to be responsible for an SE disease outbreak. In mid-August, FDA requested that Wright County Egg undertake a voluntary recall of our eggs. We promptly did so in cooperation with FDA. Our first recall was announced on August 13, 2010, which involved three of our farms. Then our second recall was announced on August 18th of 2010 and addressed eggs from other two farms. An extensive food safety investigation followed. At this time, we cannot be absolutely certain of the root cause of the contamination of the eggs we produced. However, we view that most likely root cause of contamination to be the meat and bone meal that was an ingredient in our feed. At this point, I would appreciate a projection of the first slide we provided to the committee. Meat and bone meal was produced at a rendering facility. Part of the production process and rendering involves cooking carcasses to a temperature that would eliminate SE. However, as always in food safety matters, there is a potential for recontamination either at the rendering facility, in the transportation from the rendering facility, or subsequently after the meat and bone meal is delivered to Wright County Egg. In particular, contaminated meat and bone meal that entered our bin for the ingredient could have been contaminated the bin and additional meat and bone meal that was subsequently added to the bin. The next slide, please. Thank you. Not only is this suspicion consistent with the FDA test result, but it also is consistent with the fact that the only Hillendale Farms operation to produce eggs that tested positive for the SE contamination was the Alden Farm, which received its feed from the Wright County Eggs feed mill. So all of the flocks that have been proven to be the source of this SE outbreak received feed from the Wright County Eggs feed mill. My written testimony outlines the exhaustive operational changes that Wright County is undertaking to take every precaution against this ever happening again. By focusing on our flocks, our feed, and our worker biosecurity protocols, we intend to demonstrate our commitment to the production of eggs that are of high quality and safe. We look forward to answering your questions so an accurate understanding of what caused this foodborne disease outbreak might be achieved. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Bethel, your opening statement, please, sir.
Mr. Chairman, I do not have an...
Turn on the mic, please.
Mr. Chairman, I do not have an opening statement.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Mansko?
Mr. Chairman, Dr. Burgess, and other subcommittee members, my name is Dwayne Manskow, and I am Hillendale Farms of Iowa Incorporated's production representative. I grew up in Minnesota, and upon graduation from high school, spent nearly 13 years working on a family farm with my father and brother in Ellendale, Minnesota. In the late 1980s, I entered college to study business administration. While completing my studies in 1991, I learned about feed and poultry production while working for an independent-owned grain and feed company. After graduation, I continued working with feed and poultry flocks with a farmers cooperative located in Oakland, Minnesota. Based upon my knowledge of poultry flocks, I was invited to manage production for the Interstate Value Added, IVA, farmers cooperative when it began construction in 1998. I served as the production manager and later the general manager of operations at the IVA facility in West Union, Iowa until it was purchased in December of 2007. I left the West Union facility in March of 2008 and returned at the request of Hillendale Farms of Iowa in March of 2010. I now serve as Hillendale's production representative at the West Union facility. It will probably help our discussion today if I define a few industry terms. When I talk about egg production, I mean the first of three steps in getting eggs to our customers. Egg production encompasses every aspect of farming and raising the hens up until the eggs are ready for processing. The next step, egg processing, involves cleaning, grading, and packaging the eggs. The final phase, which involves marketing and distribution, has traditionally been Hillendale's area of expertise. In order to get fresh quality eggs to market, Hillendale must be able to rely on good production and good processing. From 2008 until recently, Hillendale relied on Wright County for production in Iowa. In its 50 years of existence, I believe that Hillendale Farms, while not perfect, historically has had a record and reputation for supplying the nation with safe, quality eggs. In fact, to the best of my knowledge, Hillendale Farms had never been involved in a recall until 3 weeks ago when the FDA told us that seven people had become ill from Salmonella at a Mexican restaurant that received Hillendale, Iowa eggs. There are many other potential sources of salmonella contaminations in restaurants, and we were, to be honest, shocked by the allegation. During the prior 4 months, we had shipped about 170 million eggs from Iowa, and it was difficult to understand why FDA was saying that our eggs were responsible for seven people sick at one restaurant. The recall has, however, forced Hillendale to take a hard look at our operations and will, in the long run, make our operations better. On August 20th, we voluntarily recalled the relevant eggs, diverted all other eggs from those facilities to breaking facilities, and have been cooperating with the FDA, state officials, our customers, and this subcommittee ever since. And even if the source of the Salmonella illness is never confirmed, where we have fallen short in Iowa, we are committed to improving our operations. At Alden, where Hillendale Farms has no ownership interest, we have terminated our marketing relationship with its owner, Wright County, because we were disappointed in the test results there. At the West Union facility, we have redoubled our safety efforts and fully addressed all of the issues identified on the FDA's 483 report. We would like to emphasize, however, that no egg from West Union has tested positive for SE. Nonetheless, Hillendale has retained the former Associate Commissioner of Foods at FDA and the former head of food safety at several Fortune 200 companies, including H.J. Heinz, Campbell's Soups, and Tricon Restaurants, to conduct an intensive assessment of food safety at our West Union facility and offer recommendations. You have our commitment that we will implement any and all of these recommendations. Moreover, Hillendale Farms will continue to cooperate with all government officials, including the subcommittee, and I look forward to answering any questions that you may have. Thank you.
Thank you. That concludes testimony. We'll open up for questions. I will begin. Mr. Bethel, I'll start with you if I may. Following the outbreak of the Salmonella, federal public health officials inspected your egg facilities in Iowa over the course of 7 days. During the course of the FDA's investigation, your employee, Mr. Manskow, who is providing testimony to the committee today, accompanied the agents as they conducted the inspection. I'd like to ask you about an email you received on August 21st, 2010. In this email you received, Mr. Manskell summarized his notes from the inspection. He wrote, barn 7, put lids on the dead chicken barrels to reduce vector access. Barn 8, wet manure due to water leaks. Didn't say it needed to be removed, but they didn't like it. Barn 9, saw old dead birds in a few cages and old chicken heads on egg belts. So here's my question, and again, you're under oath, sir. Mr. Bethel, prior to receiving Mr. Manskow's email, were you aware of the conditions he noted at the Hillendale egg facilities in Iowa?
I respectfully decline to answer the question based on the protection afforded me under the Fifth Amendment of the Constitution.
Mr. Bethel, I understand that you're invoking your right against self-incrimination, which is your prerogative under the Fifth Amendment to the Constitution of the United States. Is it your intention to invoke the right to refuse any questions during this hearing?
Yes.
Okay. Then I will refrain from asking you additional questions about this subject matter and request that other members also refrain from asking you further questions. Mr. DeCoster, I'm sorry, Mr. Burgess, did...
Just simply, will I be allowed to question Mr. Bethel?
You can, but if, I mean, I think he's made it pretty clear he's going to take the Fifth Amendment to he's going to take the Fifth Amendment to any question, so.
I reserve the right to question the witness.
All right, you reserve it quite during your time. Mr. Jack DeCoster, if you will. In your testimony, you admit that your facilities had problems in the past. That's indisputable. There have been several outbreaks associated with your eggs in two states, and specifically Maryland and New York have been mentioned today, in which your eggs were actually banned. Your response is in your written testimony, you indicated that when you were small and that you have had put those problems behind us, was what you said. My question to you is this. If you've cleaned up your operations, as you say, why did this outbreak happen?
Well, Mr. Congressman, if I could answer that.
Well, that's directed at your father, so let him answer if he can. Can you answer that question?
Well, I'll try to answer it, but I'm having trouble hearing.
Okay.
Could you speak up a little bit more, please?
Sure. In your testimony, you admitted your facilities have had problems. That's indisputable. There have been several outbreaks associated with your eggs in two states we've heard from today, both Maryland and New York, where your eggs were actually banned. Your response, and in your written testimony, you said this all occurred when DeCoster Farms were small and that you've put those problems behind you. So my question is, if you've cleaned up your operations, as you say, why did this outbreak occur?
Well, this is a, Mr. Chairman, this is a complicated subject. I have to take it piece by piece, kind of. Would that be okay?
Sure. Well, let's go piece by piece and take the document binder right there. Go to binder number, tab number 16, and we'll go through it piece by piece.
16?
Yeah, right here. Look under tab 16. In August, the FDA inspectors went into your facilities. The conditions they found were appalling. Let me show you some photographs from the inspection. It's a photograph that I put up during my opening statement of decaying chickens in your egg laying facility. If you said you were following sophisticated procedures to keep your facilities clean, how do you explain dead chickens in your hen laying houses?
Mr. Congressman, this
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm talking to Mr. DeCoster, Jack DeCoster.
But he doesn't run the operation. I do.
Right, no, but
you want me to
he testified that he cleaned up that when you were small, you didn't have these problems. Okay, do you want to answer?
Yes, sir.
Okay, how do you account for dead chickens then?
Well, there's 8 den hens here that are in the back of the building. And, you know, it's kind of like a large city. There's 80,000 birds in the building.
Sure.
Occasionally we'll have some mortality. And these are taken to the back of the barn. Now, our policy is to have these in a barrel.
But they weren't at the time, were they?
No, sir, they're not.
And okay. Go through those other photos, the mice along the conveyor belt for the eggs.
But this here would not be acceptable.
Right. Either are mice by there. And go through there. Look at the manure coming out of the building from the foundations. the door. This isn't something that just happened overnight. That manure pile is about 7 to 8 feet tall. It's seeping out through cracks. So, you know, number one, you got too much manure. It's flowing out of your buildings. You got cracks. You got dead mice. You got dead chickens. You got maggots. That stuff just didn't happen. I agree you're a big operation, but with big operations come big responsibility. So how did you clean up your act? Small, and now you cleaned up your act.
Well, one at a time here on the photos, the one that shows the door being gapped open with the manure, these houses, as you can see, it's a house that's basically 18 foot at the eaves there. It's a two-story structure.
Sure.
The hen population is in the top story. This building is designed to have these manure pits, and I know this has got a lot of press, but this is a standard practice in the industry to have manure underneath the birds and then
sure.
be taken out. The problem we had here, the manure accumulation in the pit, I agree with you, is not overnight. The doors coming open like this is basically an overnight problem. The weather through this past winter and this past spring in Iowa has been unbelievable, likes that we've never seen before. And the local co-op who takes our manure out for us was just behind. They had got behind. I take full responsibility.
Or maybe you have too many birds in the house. Maybe you have too many laying hens in the house that the house can't handle all the manure coming down. You have too many birds.
No, sir. The house has got 80,000 birds. It's actually designed for 101,000.
Okay.
And the reason we have 80,000 is we follow the UEP animal welfare guidelines.
Okay.
But this problem was cleaned up that very day that this picture was taken. And what the picture doesn't show you is that there's a manure crew on site taking this manure out.
Did DeCoster Farms, you as operating officer, you knew about the FDA putting out a final rule in July? Did you comment while that rule was being developed? Did you submit comments to the FDA and how you thought the rule should be?
I don't believe I commented on the rule that came out in 09.
So you didn't need the rule to understand that this was unacceptable?
This doesn't have really much to do with the rule.
Right. I realize that.
And then what the problem I have with this is not the manure in the pit, sir, but the fact that the door is gapped open and it can allow mice inside our facility.
Sure. There's also another photo of manure coming out of the side of some holes. There's holes in your building, and the mice would have been going in those holes, but they probably couldn't get in because the manure was coming out. So with that, my time has expired. Mr. Burgess for questions.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Bethel, I understand you've asserted your privilege under the Fifth Amendment. But nevertheless, I do want to ask you one question. Please feel free to answer it if you wish. An email dated August 31st, 2010 from you to John Glessner states, quote, Hilldale needs to totally dissociate itself from Jack, and it has to be real. Hillendale has a good business base, but it will be all gone if I don't move quickly, and I will not try to deceive the public, close quote. First, do you recall sending this email? Is the reference to Jack DeCoster? And further, why did you state that Hillendale needs to disassociate itself from Jack DeCoster? And why did you feel a need to state that you will not try to deceive the public? Had someone previously asked you to deceive the public? And if so, would you please share with the committee who that would be?
I respectfully decline to answer the question based on the...
Sorry, Mr. Bethel, would you please turn on the mic and pull it forward and then read your statement again.
I respectfully decline to answer the question based on the protection afforded me under the Fifth Amendment of the Constitution.
I appreciate that. As the chairman, I did not excuse you as a witness. I felt obligated to ask you that question because it was significantly important part of our investigation. So, Mr. DeCoster, and either Mr. DeCoster, let me ask you this. You've seen the photographs. We've talked about the photographs taken by the Food and Drug Administration inspectors at your farms to document the observations made in Form 483 and show what appear to be astonishingly unsanitary conditions. How would you characterize these photographs, and do they warrant the alarm and concern being voiced here today? And if not, share with us why not.
Yes, sir. Thank you. The photo, and I haven't looked at all of them in detail, Mr. Congressman, but the rodents that were brought up in the 483, if we could take that one first, there was 31 rodents that was counted by FDA, and those 41 rodents were found in going through over 107 barns that we own. These barns cover approximately 66 acres of ground, just on the upper level, not counting the manure pits. So,
just, you know, rather than going through and dissecting out the data, do you think the alarm that has been evidenced here today, is that warranted?
I would like to invite each and every member of this board to come and view.
I wish we had that opportunity also, Mr. DeCoster, but it wasn't afforded to us by the majority. Let's go on. I may submit some questions to you in writing, but as you see, the chairman has a pretty quick gavel with me. Prior to the FDA egg rule, there were no federal requirements, testing requirements for salmonella at egg production facilities. But some states and some industry groups voluntarily set guidelines. So if the salmonella testing was not required by law, why and when and why did you start testing for salmonella?
Our reason for testing for salmonella, we first originally started testing to see if we may have it. We didn't have any trace backs. We didn't have any reported illnesses. There was no government agency that says that we should test. We tested voluntarily because we was trying to learn if we had the problem, and then if we did have the problem, what would be the best practices that we could set forward.
Yeah, now I'm going to interrupt you again. I'm not trying to be rude, but let me just suggest that if you took 72 swabs in one day and all but eight tested positive, you've got a problem.
Well, yes, sir.
Can I suggest that to you?
Well, you can suggest it, sir. But I'd like to talk to Dr. Chuck Hallfecker. He's the leading expert on this, and he's been guiding us through this whole.
And I'll tell you what, let me submit that to you in writing, because I do want to get an additional question in. Prior to the egg rule, when your company received a positive environmental result for salmonella, what corrective action did you take, and did you automatically test the eggs as a precautionary measure?
The results, we've been taking this kind of as over a period of time, we've been learning more, been working with Dr. Hallfecker, but we've implemented things such as vaccinating and then vaccinating the flocks twice as we learn more. We've eliminated molting in our system, and we've also eliminated the use of meat and bone meal.
I'm going to stop you because I'm about to run out of time. When did the FDA come to you and suggest that you needed to recall your eggs? What, do you remember the calendar date?
I'm going to say the first initial contact was a phone call, and that would have been August 12th.
And what date did the recall, did you institute the recall?
The very following day. We received that call that late afternoon, and the very next day we issued the recall.
Were you required to do so?
No, sir. It's a voluntary measure that we...
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate your indulgence.
Thank you. Does any other member wish to ask Mr. Bethel a question? Because I'm about to excuse him since he's invoked his Fifth Amendment. I'd ask members from refrain from asking him a question. The reason why I did not dismiss you after, because Mr. Burgess was insisting on asking you a question. It's not, because if I wouldn't have given him the opportunity, he would accuse me of censorship. So I thought I'd give him that opportunity. So does any other member? Seeing no other response, Mr. Bethel, you certainly invoked your rights, and that's your rights and privilege here, and thank you for being here, but you will be dismissed from this panel.
Thank you.
Mr. Waxman for questions.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Jack DeCoster, how long have you been in the business of chickens and eggs?
Since 1949, September 5th, when my dad died.
Mm-hmm. So you inherited the business from your father, as your son is doing the business.
Yes, he had
with you.
He had 125 hens. I took them over.
Now, you've had a history of over 30 years of problems with salmonella-infected eggs. And you had a pretty sordid record. You said it was because you were a small operation and you got bigger and you still operated as if you were a small operation. You had problems in the 90s and you had problems in Maine and Maryland. Now you're in Iowa and you don't want to have any problems anymore. So you said you really tried to change your operation. You modernized and cleaned up the facility. But that's not what the record indicates. FDA conducted an inspection. They did this last August. I want to read you some passages, ask you to respond. They found, quote, you failed to achieve satisfactory rodent and pest control as evidenced by the following: live and dead flies too numerous to count. The live flies were on and around egg belts, feed, and shell eggs. In addition, live and dead maggots, too numerous to count, were observed. Does this sound like a clean facility to you?
Mr. Congressman, if you don't mind, I'd like to answer the 483 questions for Iowa.
Well, I'm happy to hear from you because you're very much involved in running the operation now. But your father has been in this business for longer than you have, and he wanted to make sure he's living up to a higher standard. I want to know if he feels this is a higher standard.
Okay. Well, higher standards in the state of Maine, where I live.
Well, I'm not asking about Maine. I'm asking about the report of the inspection from the FDA. You were determined to run a clean operation, and they found all these dead flies and maggots and other problems.
Okay.
Does that bother you?
It bothers me a lot, but I feel like, Peter, we have a certain way we handle flies, a certain way we handle mice, and we have hired Maxie Nolan, who is considered an expert.
When did you hire him?
Maxie's been with coming out to our facilities since last summer, and he set up our fly and rodent program.
Well, I want to read to you another finding from the FDA, and you may want to consider firing this guy. They say, FDA said you failed to take steps to ensure that there is not introduction or transfer of SE, Salmonella enteritis, into or among the poultry houses. This was evidenced by the following observations. Uncaged birds, chickens having escaped, were observed in the egg-laying operation in contact with the egg-laying birds. The uncaged birds were using the manure, which was approximately 8 feet high, to access the egg-laying area. What this means is that the chickens had escaped the hen house. They're walking in the manure pit and then mixing in with the caged birds. Do you agree with the FDA that this is a violation of appropriate safety standards or procedures?
We're kind of jumping around a little bit. We're going from rodents to flies to loose chickens. But if we want to stick with the loose chicken for a minute, they observed two or three loose chickens that had got out of their cages in a couple different houses. And in the course of our barn men doing their work, they will access the cage for whether it be a sick hen, a water nipple that may be leaking or need repair. And a chicken can escape when they open the door, or if they forget to close the door completely, a chicken can escape. Now, these chickens...
Mr. DeCosta, let me interrupt you to say this.
But they're not...
You've had problems in the past, right? Over 30 years of problems in different states. You had a call from the FDA to recall your eggs, and you voluntarily did that. And then the inspection took place.
Yes.
That's when the FDA found all these problems. You've claimed that you're going to modernize and clean up your facility. But it doesn't appear that you've modernized and cleaned up your facilities. It sounds like, to me, that both of you are refusing to take responsibility for a very poor facility. According to the FDA inspections, they found all these problems. You would think after you were called on to recall the eggs, you would have made sure your facility was cleaned up. Maybe you did. Maybe this is as clean as you got it, but it still looked pretty dirty. How do you respond to that?
Well, hopefully I'll be allowed to finish this time, but I mean, we're jumping all over the place. You're not giving me fair time to answer the question. And then
I'm going to have your father respond, because he talked about how he wanted to clean up the facility. And I want to ask him to tell us whether he approves the conditions and how his son operates the facility. After this FDA inspection, all of these problems they just found, after the recall already started, do you think this is a satisfactory way for the facility to be run?
Mr. Congressman, I'm not.
No, I've asked your father. I've asked your father, and I'm asking the questions. Mr. Jack DeCoster?
Yes. I follow what you're saying, okay? However, this is a very big operation. We have a certain way we go about running it, regardless.
You had problems when you ran it that way, and you were going to clean it up. So is this where you are now, is you feel cleaned up and adequate?
Sir, please, let me talk, okay? We have a certain way that our barn man goes into the chicken house. He has a certain way he does this work, okay? He starts in the morning, he pulls out the dead chickens. He spends a certain amount of time checking the egg belts, taking the dead chickens out, checking the water, checking the lights. Then what he does, he goes and he sweeps all of the barns. He goes into the pits, he checks the leaking water is coming down from upstairs into the pit. He checks loose birds in the pit. He puts light bulbs in if there's any missing light bulbs. He's supposed to be checking this door that was pushed out. That door would not stay like that very long.
Mr. DeCoster, yes. We only have a certain amount of time, and my time is pretty much over, but I do want to tell you this.
I'm sorry.
It's hard for me to reconcile your words that you wanted to clean up, and you did clean up the facility, with the record before the committee. The conditions in your facility were not clean. They were not sanitary. They were filthy. And given the 30-year record of violations, it appears that you are a habitual violator of basic safety standards. And I must say, for you to come before us and say, it's the feed, we had nothing to do with it, is hard for me to believe and accept on at face value. My time has expired, but I just want you to know my thoughts about it.
Gentleman's time has expired. Mr. Latta for questions, please.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Coster, Peter, looking at this report, this 483 that was date issued was August the 30th. How often has the FDA been inspecting?
That's the first time the FDA's been to our facilities.
For any of your facilities, okay.
Well, for the barns.
Okay.
Chicken barns.
Okay, let me ask, is the USDA on your premises at all times or at the different houses?
The USDA AMS does grading of our processing plants, all of our processing facilities. We have the voluntary program of USDA, which we incur the costs.
Okay, but again, I know I've been in different houses and facilities, and there's usually somebody from USDA. But is there a USDA person on the premises part of the time, all the time?
USDA would be in the processing plant during the hours of operation, okay. Generally from 6 in the morning till whenever we finish in the afternoon.
Okay. Do you have the Department of Agriculture in Iowa inspecting out there? Does the Department of Agriculture in Iowa inspect the facilities?
No, sir. The DNR would inspect any environmental type issues, but Department of Ag's never been out to inspect.
Okay. What's your DNR do?
It stands for the Department of Natural Resources.
Right, right. But I mean, what's their role on the farm then?
Their role is basically on any environmental issue. If manure threatens the water of the states, would be one of the major ones.
Okay, when they do their, now do they do like an inspection of the houses around the facility? Do they do water quality tests like, I come from the largest county in the state of Ohio that has ditches. I got 3,000 miles of ditches in my home county. And so, if there's, are they doing water quality tests in ditches, or is that what they're doing? They're away from the facility, or are they on the facility site?
Yes, the only thing they would inspect on the facility is a complaint, or if they're It's an annual inspection on the lagoons.
Okay, and talking about, like, with the lagoon, and I heard what you said about it was a wet spring out there, and I know it was a wet spring in Ohio trying to get crops out. What's your manure management plan? Do you have to file that with someone?
Yes, there's manure management plans on every CAFO in Iowa. Our manure management plan, because we do the sale of our manure with the local co-op who uses it for fertilizer, they have the manure management plan.
Okay, and who do you file that CAFO plan with?
The DNR.
DNR. Okay, so if they're, now, because I know we just talked about them, you know, looking at water quality and things like that, does the DNR then do any inspection around the buildings then for the CAFO?
Not on a regular basis, but the DNR, after, I guess, reading some of the articles in the newspaper, came up and did a inspection around our layer barns and said everything looked okay. I haven't heard anything more.
Okay. Let me ask you then, and when you say they come not that often, how often would they come around from DNR on that end?
Normally under those type circumstances, if they're called out to do it.
So they wouldn't do it on like a six-month or 12-month basis? Okay. Now, who hauls your, how often do you have to clean your barns? Now, are your barns deep pit, or do you have conveyor?
The majority of our barns are deep pit, like the pictures show here, but we do have one facility that's a belt battery where the manure is removed on a daily basis and put in another barn.
And then with a deep pit, how do you get that out? Are you using like skidders, bobcats?
Yes, skid steers. Okay. Bobcat would be a brand that would be used, but they go through these doors that are shown in the picture.
Okay. And how often would they do that?
Our program was to clean every barn every other year, and we did that for measure of fly control. Fresh manure, you tend to have it's a better environment for the flies, so we was going with every other year, which we've changed that policy last year to remove the manure every year.
Okay. Hey, Mr. Chairman, I think my time's expired, and I yield back.
Thank you, Mr. Latta. Mr. Braley for questions, please.
Thank you. Gentlemen, you weren't here earlier when I delivered the ode to the Iowa egg. And I can tell you I have personally been supporting the Iowa egg industry for 53 years, and there's no bigger fan of the products you produce. But I also was sitting down to breakfast in a restaurant when I first heard about this story. And I can tell you it literally made me sick to my stomach and caused me to order something different on the menu. And then I was down at the Iowa State Fair earlier this year in the Varied Industries building looking at a lot of very nervous egg producers with the Iowa Egg Council. So I'm going to ask each one of you, do you feel any personal responsibility to the impact that this recall, this massive recall, is having on Iowa egg producers? Mr. Manskow?
It is too bad that this occurred, and we do feel sorry that for any inconvenience and cost that it has caused the industry.
I apologize to the two Mr.s DeCoster, but it's easier if I just refer to you by your first names, if that's all right.
That's fine.
Peter?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, this is an issue that I feel terrible that has occurred, and it's affecting our industry.
Jack?
I feel very bad about it, a very, very bad. It's a horrible thing.
Well, the problem that egg producers in Iowa and all over the country are facing is a series of headlines, like the one in today's New York Times, An Iowa Egg Farmer and a History of Salmonella, the Los Angeles Times, Filthy Conditions Found at Egg Producers, Egg Farms Violated Safety Rules, FDA Details Numerous Violations at Egg Farms, Egg Recall Mouse Fly Infestations Date Back 10 Years, Workers Say, Tainted eggs reveal lapse in state protocol. And the problem that a lot of us have here on this committee is a sense that
there is a disconnect between the problems identified in these stories and identified in the FDA's investigation and the sense of responsibility. And we had two witnesses who testified at the earlier panel who talked about the personal impact that the salmonella contamination had on them. Here's the story in today's New York Times. On July night in 1987, scores of elderly and chronically ill patients at Burt S. Kohler Memorial Hospital in New York City began to fall violently ill with food poisoning from eggs tainted with salmonella. It was like a war zone, said Dr. Philip Tassi, the doctor on call as sickness started to rage through the hospital. By the time the outbreak ended, more than 2 weeks later, 9 people had died and about 500 people had become sick. It remains the deadliest outbreak in this country attributed to eggs infected with the bacteria known as Salmonella enteritidis. This year, the same bacteria sickened thousands of people nationwide and led to a recall of 500 million eggs. Despite the gap of decades, there is a crucial link between the two outbreaks. In both cases, the eggs came from farms owned by Austin J. DeCoster, one of the country's biggest egg producers. And Jack, I think one of the things that people around the country are asking is, if your company's commitment to food safety is as strong as you've indicated in your opening statement to this committee, how is it possible that after all this time, we have another DeCoster egg producer involved in a $500 million recall?
Well, the question is complicated, sir.
I'd like the record to reflect that the counsel for the witness has handed him a document.
Congressman, this SC happened 23 years ago in one of our farms in Maryland. We destroyed the flocks. After we destroyed the flocks, we cleaned it all out, washed it all up, and then put the new pullets in it. And then it wasn't very long after that after we put the new pullets in, which we bought these pullets from a company in Indiana. They wasn't ones that we raised, or at least not all of the ones we put in the complex. And after we get it all filled up again with new birds, all clean, we thought, and we had also a person from Pennsylvania, a doctor, coming down to our flocks and testing all of them, reporting that they was okay. And then we had a reason to take a bird or a few birds down to the Salisbury Laboratory in Maryland. And we took them down and they found SE in a bird, or I don't remember too clearly right now, but they at least found salmonella in the birds. So then FDA came over to our place, and way back then FDA came over, and they tested every one of our flocks and our chicken houses. And if I remember this correctly, this is a long time ago, but we had to take out at least half of all the flocks again. Maybe it was a 7-house complex. We had to take at least 3 to 4 flocks out. We had to wash it all again, and then we filled it back up again. And then, as I remember it the next time, it was okay.
Mr. Chairman, my time has expired, but I would ask unanimous consent to submit for the record the editorials that I referred to earlier in my questioning.
Without objection. Before they're entered, request to see them. So if you'd provide them, we'll look at them. If without objection, we'll put it in then. Mr. Dingell for questions, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I commend you for this hearing and for the extraordinary leadership that you've given in our efforts to reform and to enhance the powers of FDA. My questions are going to remind me of a day in 1990 when this subcommittee went into the questions of food safety, and indeed in salmonella and eggs. I'd like to welcome you both, Messrs. DeCoster, and I begin my question by saying this. The Food and Drug Administration's staff reports on this matter, which I ask unanimous consent be inserted in the record, say,
without objection,
refer to inquiries about your facilities. And they say, barns were infested with flies, maggots, and scurrying rodents, manure piled 4 to 8 feet high in certain areas, leaking manure pits, employees working without protective clothing, and uncaged hens tracking manure from manure pit to other areas of the operation. Is that true?
We've, if we could take one of these at a time, the comment about the employees.
Well, it's either true or not. Is it true or is it not true? Yes or no?
I would say that it's partially true.
Partially true. Well, that's like being partially pregnant. It's pretty hard to do. Now, having said this, you were having trouble in the 90s, and it resulted in a calamitous situation at the Bird S. Kohler Memorial Hospital in New York, just referred to by one of my colleagues. I'm curious here. You dispute any of the allegations made in the reports by Food and Drug? Yes or no?
On the 483?
The reports of the Food and Drug staff to Food and Drug. Do you dispute any of the statements in those with regard to the conditions at your farms?
Yes, sir. When we did our closing.
Specifically, which ones do you dispute?
Okay, the one that you brought up about the people going from one barn to another, that was not specified in the FDA's rule. That it says, and even in their guidance document.
Okay, is that your only dispute?
No, sir.
What others do you dispute?
Well, the dispute we had also, that they named some manure doors that they said was pushed open with manure, and they were not. There was only 4 doors that were like that out of the 292.
Right. Now, dispute the finding that there were live mice and dead flies too numerous to count in your facilities?
I would say there was live and dead flies. This is a farm. They are chicken barns. We have a very stringent fly program that Dr. Maxie Nolan has laid out even tougher than the FDA rules.
Do you dispute the statement of Food and Drug that these conditions do not promote safety and quality?
I guess I'm not familiar with that statement.
What plans do you have in place to prevent salmonella contamination?
We've outlined a very extensive plan that we submitted to the FDA.
Would you submit those plans for the record, if you please?
Yes, I'd be more than happy to.
Now, I understand that 2 positive SE samples were collected from your feed mill. Is this true?
Yes, there was 2 swabs that were positive.
The source is thought to be a raw ingredient acquired from a third party. Is this true?
That's what we believe, sir.
What level of responsibilities do you have for the ingredients you receive from third parties and subsequently use in your operations?
We've put in a full array of testing. We're taking samples from every incoming load. We've talked to all of our vendors for them also to do testing. We're going to do a composite on these loads weekly and send them in for testing. We're going to do a monthly swabbing of our feed mill. We are currently in the process of completely cleaning and disinfecting the entire mill from top to bottom. And we've done extensive employee training to to make sure that the mill is kept tightened up so that there is no open hatches, as noted in the 483.
What steps do you take to ensure that those planned or announced safeguards are implemented?
We have a daily inspection by the mill manager. Then we have an outside supervisor who's going to inspect the facilities once a week and give me a full report.
Do you still have your hog operations?
We own some hog facilities, but we don't own any hog. We don't operate hog facilities. We just lease them.
I see. Mr. Chairman, I note with some distress my time is up, and I thank you for your courtesy.
Thank you, Mr. Dingell. Ms. DeGette, for questions, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. DeCoster, your company hires a private auditing company to audit Wright County Farms annually, correct?
Yes, ma'am.
And this company is AIB, which is a private for-profit food safety auditing firm, correct?
Right. They're sent in by our customer's request.
Okay. And if you'll turn to tab 5 of the notebook in front of you, on June 7th and 8th, 2010, your farm was actually inspected by AIB, correct?
Yes, ma'am.
And AIB actually issued a superior certificate to the farm, correct?
Yes, they did.
And this has been happening. You get inspected annually, and if you'll take a look at tab 7 of your notebook, on August 20th, 2008, the farm was also, that's a different one. Let's just stick with tab 5 for a minute. I'll talk about tab 7 in a second. So AIB audited your company in 2008 two times, four times in 2009, and at least one time in 2010, and every time you were found to be superior. Is that correct?
Yes, this is an inspection of the processing facility.
Uh-huh.
And not of the chicken barn.
Okay. And what I wanted to talk about with tab 7, if you'll look at that, unbelievably to this committee, in 2009, AIB was the same auditor that audited the Peanut Corporation of America and also gave them a superior recommendation. Do you see that in your notebook as well?
Yes, ma'am.
So here's the thing, is both the Peanut Corporation of America and Wright County Egg paid AIB to audit their companies and received superior ratings right before both companies sold products that sickened thousands of people with Salmonella. And Mr. Chairman, I bring this up to say that just relying on third-party auditors is not going to guarantee consumer safety, which is why, getting back to all of our point, we need to pass this bill. I wanted to ask you a couple of questions, Mr. Mangshaw. In your opening statement, you said, in order to get fresh quality eggs to market, Hillendale must be able to rely on good production and good processing, correct?
That is correct.
You can't have good production and good processing without a clean and up to standard facility, correct?
Yes.
And you also said in your opening statement that you were surprised. It was difficult to understand why FDA was saying your eggs were responsible for 7 people sick at one restaurant, correct? Because you thought that your processes were good. Is that right?
That's correct.
Okay. Now, the FDA inspected your facilities August 19th through August 26, 2010, and they found numerous, quote, unsealed rodent holes, liquid manure streaming from a crack in the manure pit, and uncaged hens tracking manure through the laying facilities. Do you think that that's up to a standard of care, sir?
The rodent holes were open.
Okay. Do you think those findings are consistent with a high standard of care at the facility? Yes or no?
No.
Thank you. Now, you said a minute ago when someone asked you about Mr. Braley actually asked you about the effect on the egg industry, and you said You apologized for any inconvenience. Do you have any idea how much the egg industry's profits have gone down because of these recalls?
I would not know.
Do you know that, Mr. DeCoster?
No, ma'am. I don't have knowledge of that.
All right. Well, Mr. Chairman, I think we'll find that out because I'm sure it's millions and millions of dollars.
Yes.
Mr. DeCoster, I wanted to ask you one last question, and that is, Chairman Waxman was talking to you about the condition of the facilities, which you apologized for, but you also seemed to think that perhaps that the salmonella came in the feed, correct?
That's what we're believing at the moment.
Okay. So here's my question. You're running large egg facilities. Do you have a regular system where you test the feed that comes in to make sure that it's not contaminating the chickens that eat it?
We don't test. We did not test.
Are you going to establish such a system now, sir?
Yes, ma'am. That's what I was talking about earlier with the testing every load and doing a weekly composite and sending that into the lab.
Right.
We're currently doing.
Probably you should have been doing that all along, huh?
Yes.
Hindsight, yes, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Gett. Mr. Doyle for questions, please.
Thanks. Mr. Manskow, I want to ask you about the role you played in Hillendale's egg operations in Iowa. When did you start working for Hillendale Farms?
I was hired in March of 2010.
And at the time of the recall, what were your responsibilities at the two facilities?
I was overseeing the plant at West Union and trying to work into the opportunity to have more control of the day-to-day productions at the Alden facility.
Now, I understand that one Hillendale facility is located in Alden, Iowa, and in a letter to committee staff dated September 17, 2010, the lawyers for the company wrote that in this facility, Hillendale, quote, has virtually no authority over the production and processing aspects. And in regards to the second facility in West Union, your company lawyer stated that Hillendale has limited responsibility for the production and processing phases of that facility. Mr. Mantev, can you clarify what role Hillendale played at these two facilities?
When I was hired in March by Hillendale Farms, they wanted me to come back and work with the West Union facility initially, start to take a role in the day-to-day operations there, and as time went on, hopefully to work into some day-to-day control at the Alden facility.
Mm-hmm. Who owned the buildings on these farms?
To the best of my knowledge, Wright County Farms owns the Alden facility and has a shared interest in the West Union facility.
How about the chickens? Who owns the chickens?
I don't have any direct knowledge on who owns those.
How many Hillendale employees do you have at each of these facilities?
The people at West Union are Hillendale employees. It varies up and down, and there's probably in the 40s in payroll there.
In your testimony, you stated that Hillendale has terminated its marketing relationship with Wright County Egg at the Alden facility. To your knowledge, does Hillendale have any other business relationships in other states with Mr. DeCoster or any of his associates?
That's outside of the scope of my job duties.
So I guess I get Hillendale didn't make the eggs, Wright County did, but you're a major egg producer too. And you know, you're in a position to know whether you're running a clean and safe operation. Let me ask you, in light of this recall, how has this changed the culture at Hillendale on how you produce eggs and do business?
Well, it's definitely going to make us take a closer look at what we do. We have hired two consultants to come in. The the gal that was at the FDA and a person with food safety at several Fortune 200 food companies. We brought them in. They're going to be doing recommendations to improve our food safety programs. They We have discontinued our agreement with the Wright County Farms at Alden. We have we will no longer be receiving pullets that Wright County has raised for the West Union facility. We are bringing on another staff position at West Union to increase and do a better job of documentation on quality control.
Okay, well, Hillendale Farms is a brand I see in my store all the time in Pittsburgh, and I venture to say that I've eaten hundreds of your eggs. I want to continue to feel good about picking those boxes up when I go to the supermarket. The important thing that comes out of this hearing and subsequently, if we can finally get a bill out of the Senate, we just want to make sure that every consumer, when they go into that store, has a good feeling about a brand when they see it, and your company has a pretty good reputation in my neck of the woods. So I was surprised to see your name mentioned when this broke up. But I hope it's a wake-up call to everybody in the industry that Americans have a right to expect that when they buy your food, your products, that you're not going to make them sick or worse yet, cause them to die. Mr. Chairman, I see my time's expired.
Thank you, Mr. Doyle. That concludes the questions from the panel. I'm going to excuse this panel, and thank you for coming today, but you'd be excused. We'll go to our third panel in a moment here. On our third panel today, we have Dr. Josh Sharfstein, Deputy Commissioner, Food and Drug Administration. It's the policy of this subcommittee to take all testimony under oath. Please be advised that you have the right under the rules of the House to be advised by counsel during your testimony. Do you wish to be represented by counsel?
No.
Okay. Then I'm going to ask you, please rise, raise your right hand, take the oath. You swear or affirm the testimony you're about to give to be the truth, the whole truth, nothing but truth, a matter pending before this committee?
Yes.
Let the record reflect, the witness has stated that you testify in the affirmative, that he understands he is now under oath. Dr. Sharfstein, welcome, and you may begin your opening statement, please.
Thank you. Good afternoon, Chairman Stupak, Congressman Burgess, and members of the subcommittee. I am Joshua Sharfstein, the Principal Deputy Commissioner of the U.S. Food and Drug Administration. Thank you for the opportunity to appear before you today to discuss the recent foodborne illness outbreak caused by Salmonella enteritidis. I would like to provide some general background on egg safety, discuss the outbreak and response, and then talk about what FDA and Congress can do to further protect the food supply. Salmonella enteritidis, or SE as it is known, is a pathogen known to contaminate eggs. Contamination can occur when bacteria is passed from the chicken to the inside of the egg, or when bacteria passes through fractures in the shell. If not fully cooked, eggs with Salmonella enteritidis can cause human disease. If an egg farm is out of control for Salmonella enteritidis, then many thousands of illnesses can result. It is estimated that contaminated eggs cause as many as 140,000 illnesses a year in the United States. In 1999, FDA announced an egg safety action plan to reduce this enormous burden of illness. FDA staff pushed for a decade to put into place specific safety standards at egg production facilities. The agency finalized its rule in July 2009 with provisions to take effect starting in July 2010. FDA's egg rule requires producers to have a clear plan for preventing SE contamination and to implement recognized control measures that reduce the risk of contamination, including buying chicks and young hens only from suppliers who meet standards for producing SE-free birds, establishing rodent, pest control, and other biosecurity measures to prevent the spread of bacteria throughout the farm, conducting testing of the poultry house environment for Salmonella enteritidis, and if an environmental sample is found positive, testing eggs and disinfecting the house before adding new laying hens, diverting eggs that have been found to be positive to processed uses, and refrigerating eggs at 45 degrees Fahrenheit during storage and transportation. Before implementation of this important rule took effect, the number of SE cases nationwide began to grow in late spring. By July, CDC had noticed a significant increase, and several states had begun conducting epidemiological investigations to identify the source of the problem. FDA set up an emergency response team to help sort through the various theories of what was causing the outbreak and identify its source. The agency relied upon its field staff in multiple states, and working with CDC and our state and local partners, we traced the problem to eggs produced at several Iowa farms. As soon as this traceback was completed, FDA recommended and Wright County Egg agreed to a major recall of eggs from the linked farms. FDA also sent inspectors in to look at the conditions of the nearby farms, also under Wright Egg and Hillendale, as additional epidemiological evidence accumulated. Because of concerns about the conditions of these farms, FDA recommended and Wright County Egg and Hillendale farms agreed to additional recalls. Significantly, these recalls totaling 500 million eggs came about 2 weeks before any positive lab findings. FDA acted before confirmatory evidence became available, using our best judgment to protect the public health. What caused the SE outbreak? FDA inspectors found numerous problems at both farms. These included significant deficiencies in pest control, significant problems with the handling of manure, and significant gaps in biosecurity measures to prevent cross-contamination. We also identified the SE matching the outbreak strain in the feed mill supply in the farms, which is associated with Wright County Egg, in environmental samples at multiple locations on the farms, and in the water used to clean the eggs at the Hillendale farm. We believe that there are multiple potential sources of introduction for SE on these farms. Once introduced, these farms did not have the systems in place to control the spread. In fact, some of the deficiencies likely contributed to the spread of SE, leading to widespread contamination. Prevention of foodborne illness is what consumers expect and deserve from our food safety system. With our state and federal counterparts, we are reviewing this outbreak to understand what the agency can do to improve its work on behalf of the public. Now that the egg rule is in place, FDA is moving to quickly inspect other egg facilities to assure that strong preventive efforts are in place. We intend to inspect all 600 or so large egg facilities that are now subject to the rule by the end of calendar year 2011. In order for these inspections to be successful, in order for these inspections to be as successful as possible, there is something Congress can do to help us. Proposed legislation will give FDA more tools as we're doing these inspections to assure compliance, including enhanced administrative detention authority, civil money penalties, stronger criminal penalties, and mandatory recall. This critical legislation will also do a lot more than help make eggs safer. It would give FDA the tools to establish appropriate prevention standards much more efficiently across the food supply, and it would strengthen FDA's ability to hold companies accountable for meeting these standards with a new inspection mandate, new resources, and stronger enforcement tools. The legislation would also strengthen our ability to respond to problems through new traceability standards, mandatory recall authority, and closer collaboration with our state partners to build upon and leverage their frontline capacities. We hope this Congress will take the historic step of enacting comprehensive food safety legislation to give FDA the resources and tools we need for a modern and effective food safety system. Thank you very much. I'm happy to take questions.
Thank you, Doctor. I'll begin with the questions. Salmonella enteritidis is a major cause of foodborne illnesses in the United States. In fact, in your testimony, you said 140,000 people Americans become sick in each year from it. And to my understanding, approximately 30 deaths per year are directly related to the consumption of eggs contaminated with Salmonella. My question, and as we've heard today, Mr. Dingell started about 1990 where he had a Salmonella and eggs hearing with this committee. Mr. Braley mentioned New York Times. You mentioned 1999, the FDA began to develop a rule. It's my understanding that the Clinton administration in 2000 put forth a proposed rule. Then it's my understanding nothing happened until 2004, then President Bush put forth a proposed rule. Then what happened between 2004 and July of 2010? Why did it take, if you will, 11 years to get a rule out on this? Did different administration just abandon this effort? I mean, the Obama administration has been here since January of 2009, and you put a proposed rule out in July of 2009, am I correct?
That's
and,
correct.
And then there's a year of comments and back and forth, correct? Public
actually,
comment?
It was a year for implementation. I mean, I started at the very end of March as the acting commissioner, and by July we had issued the proposed rule. This was a very high priority for the administration.
Okay. So do you know what happened as you put forth the proposed rule in July of 2009? What happened between 2004, I understand President Bush put it forward. What happened between 2004 and 2009? 5 years we lost?
You know, I wasn't at the agency at that time.
Could you have a agency put up a timeline and see what happened starting back in 1999 when it was first proposed?
Sure.
Because for a lot of people, it seems pretty preposterous. It takes us 11 years to put forth a rule.
Well, you know, I can tell you that some people who are career employees at FDA have been interviewed about that question.
Okay.
And I'll quote one, Bill Hubbard, who you may know, who's testified before the committee. And this is a direct quote from him, that the FDA simply couldn't get through to the White House. They were very hostile to regulation. I was told that each time FDA tried to get the rule cleared through OMB, the response was that they were, quote, not enough bodies in the street, that the number of cases, hospitalizations, and deaths did not rise to the level to justify greater regulation of egg producers. Obviously, public health officials felt strongly that there was a strong justification, but the prevailing attitude at the time within the administration was that regulation was an evil that should be avoided unless there was a compelling argument for government action. That was what Bill Hubbard stated.
Okay. Yes, after today, we have enough compelling arguments on why we need this final rule for egg. But the final rule was put out July 9th, 2010. And aims at reducing the amount of eggs contaminated with harmful salmonella. The rule applies to egg producers with 3,000 or more egg-laying hens. This means both Hillendale Farm and Wright County Egg must comply with the new rules. And when, in questions, both the gentleman from Hillendale and DeGoster Farms knew about the new rule. But what do we need to implement this rule? I have a copy of the summary from the FDA of the on these two farms, or these farms here that we have had the egg recall, starting in September 4, 2008 to June 12, 2009, there were approximately 178 violations. After the rules out, starting on July 31st through of 2009 to July 26, 2010, there's 207 violations. So it looks like during this period of time when you have the proposed rule, it does look like these farms are trying to do anything to comply with the rule. We have actually increased salmonella outbreaks after the rule's been proposed.
You're referring to their testing of salmonella at the
Correct.
Facility, I believe.
Correct.
You know, those results were not disclosed to FDA, and under our rule, if you get a contaminated finding in the facility, you have to go ahead and test the eggs. So that there would be a different response to that, those findings under the rule.
All right. So underneath the proposed rule, or the final rule, I should say, if I have a positive test, I have to report it to the FDA?
If you have a positive test as part of the testing procedure, it is, in fact, available to the FDA.
But they'd have to notify you, correct?
We'll have to get back on whether they
right.
affirmatively notify us. I think.
Okay. Well, then let me ask you
it's
this.
It's not reported to us, but it's available to us.
Okay. Let me ask you this. How would the newly implemented egg rule, what does that really mean for the American consumer? What can we expect?
It means a lot because it means that we can go now to all the major egg facilities and we can make sure that they have very important preventive safeguards in place, including approach to rodents that keeps the rodents out of the eggs, an approach to general contamination, an approach to refrigeration, and an approach to testing so that they can have confidence that the farms in the United States, as you know, overseen by FDA with you know, an independent look,
okay.
are following things to prevent illness in the first place.
This final rule that's now in place and has the effect applies to those farms, egg-producing farms, 3,000 or more egg-laying hens. How many farms is that in the United States? We've heard from two today, but how many are there?
I know that there are about 600 that are 50,000 or more. Okay. I think there's several thousand that are between 3,000 and 50,000. We'd have to get the exact number to you.
Okay. My time has expired. Mr. Burgess for questions.
Thank you, Dr. Sharfstein, for being here. So now you have the ability to inspect egg-producing facilities. Is that correct?
That's correct.
And now this just came under your jurisdiction in July?
No, what started in July...
Well, let me ask you a question. Did you have the ability to do these egg inspections in 1999, 2004, 1990, all of these other dates that have been mentioned?
FDA has standards against which we could inspect.
Were you prohibited from inspecting?
No.
Let me ask you this, and I guess you've already answered the question about how many egg production facilities are under your jurisdiction, 600 large-scale productions with greater than 50,000 hens. Now, over the last 5 years, could you give us the total number of inspections that have been done?
We have been in some of these facilities because of outbreaks, and we could give you the number of inspections, but we have not done general inspections, and I think that there are two reasons for that.
Okay, number of general inspections then would be zero.
I don't believe we did any inspections proactively.
Okay, I'm just trying to ascertain.
Sure.
It's come up to us in newspaper articles that Acosta's, they've kind of attracted some attention in the past. Mm-hmm. Why wouldn't you look?
Sure.
Well, Bob Lotta brought it up a moment ago, you had a companion agency on the street, in the hen house, if you will.
Right.
Did they not see an 8-foot tall pile of manure? Did they not see a door that was broken down with a manure pile pushing outside? Mm. What do they look at while they're there? Just the size of the egg and whether it's grade A?
Well, I can't speak for USDA, but there are
so important and sickens so many people, by your estimation, 100,000 cases a year, and it's a high-risk food, why wouldn't there be a tendency for cross-communication between a federal agency under the USDA and the Food and Drug Administration?
Well, FDA has been very concerned about this potential risk. That's why FDA fought
to put this rule. I'd say not enough. If the USDA is not, an 8-foot pile, we showed the pictures. That's got to get your attention. I know you're just there to measure with a little micrometer the diameter of the egg, but holy cow, how do you just not notice that? And if you know this is a high-risk food and a high-risk practice, and the DeCosters kind of have a history, why wouldn't someone say something? Okay, we've got a food safety bill that's over in the Senate. And we've heard all kinds of stuff today about the problems. I supported the food safety bill. I worked on it. I tried to amend it. I tried to make it a better product. Ultimately, it wasn't perfect, but I voted for it, both in committee and on the floor of the House. But really, what did you have in that bill that you didn't already have? The recall, we heard the DeCosters testify. The minute the recall was suggested to them, boom, they flipped the switch. They recalled the eggs. So it wasn't like you had to go to court to get a court order to do it. They voluntarily did that. So, all right, we're going to have a mandatory recall of the new bill. That's great. But it didn't affect the outcome here. What would have affected the outcome here is if one federal agency had used common sense and talked to another federal agency. How do we legislate that between the FDA and the USDA?
FDA and USDA are working on improving communication. But I think from my perspective, this rule is what gives FDA the ability to be at these facilities inspecting for prevention, and the law allows us to make those inspections. Those inspections as effective as possible.
My time is very short. Let me ask you a question about the law. You brought it up yourself. You talked about civil and criminal culpability.
Right.
Is there the ability to bring criminal charges against one of these producers now if the conditions are found to be so egregious that they should have been stopped?
Yes. There would be enhanced criminal penalties under the bill.
But criminal penalties exist today. Nothing is stopping you or nothing is preventing the Department of Justice from pursuing this if they decide to do so. It's unusual to have salmonella inside the egg, isn't it?
Not at this facility, I don't think.
But just in general. Now, would there be any way the consumer would know? I mean, if you've got a rotten egg, we all know, you crack a rotten egg and it's trouble. But this wouldn't create that kind of trouble, would it?
Correct.
Have there been any other cases where salmonella has occurred inside, and any other of the food recall, the egg recalls that FDA has overseen, have there been issues with salmonella internal to the egg?
Absolutely.
So do you have you have other studies that you have done that where you can compare and contrast what you're doing now with what has happened in the past? And I'd appreciate if you'd provide that to us. I'll provide that question in writing.
I think this is a known risk, and that's why FDA has fought so hard.
But generally, it's on the outside of the egg, not internal to the egg. So I'd just like an accounting of where the FDA has been in the past with this. Finally, let me just ask you. You said you started in March of 2009. I appreciated the kindness you showed me when I went out for a tour of your facility. That's 18 months, so when can we expect, under your tenure, and I'm sorry we don't have the CEO of the FDA here today, but under your tenure, when can we expect this to be better? You've had 18 months. Mm-hmm. You've known it's a problem. When's it going to improve?
I believe that we're in a position, through these inspections, to inspect the facilities that produce 80% of the eggs by the end of fiscal year 2011. And I believe as we do that, and we assure under the rule that we put into place very quickly in the Obama administration, we will be able to feel a lot more confident about the conditions under which the vast majority of eggs are produced.
So we won't be back
in the next time. Has expired. Mr. Waxman, questions, please.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Dr. Sharfstein, seems to me you have had a number of problems. You didn't have this egg rule in place. It's now in place. Can you tell us succinctly what it will do to help FDA prevent this problem in the future?
Sure. The egg rule requires certain types of preventive measures that keep salmonella from getting in the eggs. And these include standards around rodent control. It includes standards around refrigeration. And it includes testing protocols, because salmonella does, even in the best managed facilities, get in, but you've got to identify it quickly and control it. So those are three examples. And the firms must have their own plan, and they must keep to the plan. And by being able to inspect against the plan, we can have a high level of assurance that we will not see these situations again.
Then why do we need the law to be changed as per the House passed bill on food safety? How will that help you?
It will help. We're looking at 600 inspections by the end of fiscal year 2011. Right now, we have very limited authority to do administrative detention. We have no ability to do civil penalties. We have limited criminal penalties. There are a number of things that will directly help us in this task of inspecting the other 600 facilities that we would like to inspect by the end of fiscal year 2011. And then, of course, the bill goes far beyond just eggs. And there are other products out there where there are not standards. And we don't want to spend a decade putting those standards into place. We want preventive standards in place much faster for other products. So we are not back here every 6 months, as the committee has noted, talking about another major food recall.
Mr. Burgess seemed to, in the way he asked the question, I got the sense he was saying you don't really need this law because you have a lot of authority now. Can you demand a recall, or do you have to rely on the company to voluntarily recall a product?
Well, I appreciate that Congressman Burgess supports the bill.
Yes, he does.
And I think that right now we cannot demand a recall. It has to be voluntary. And I do think, you know, in this case, we're very pleased that as soon as we recommended a recall, you know, even before we had confirmatory lab testing, the company did it. But we have 600 to go. And if we wind up in prolonged court battles with some of those companies, we don't know what could happen. It is much better, if we need to protect the public, for us to be able to order a recall.
How about penalties? If you find that some companies have been acting inappropriately, and obviously penalties deter for the future, what can you do? Now?
Now. There are certain types of criminal penalties, but it requires a, you know, very, and actually I could get you the exact penalties, but it obviously requires a big investigation to get there. We do not have the authority to assess civil money penalties, which the bill would give us. So it would be a much more flexible type of tool, much more, give us a stronger teeth for what we want to do to protect the public via prevention-oriented inspections.
Well, that's civil penalties. How about criminal penalties? If you have a company that over a 30-year period constantly gets into trouble because they have salmonella in, let's say, eggs, and they've been assessed civil money penalties, they've been told by the states they can't sell their eggs in the states, in certain states, any longer. What more can you say if they continue to act in a way that causes this problem to reoccur?
Well, criminal penalties are, you know, an option available to the agency, and they would be strengthened under the bill.
Under the bill, but right now, you have to go to the Justice Department?
Correct.
And has the Justice Department ever sought criminal penalties, to your knowledge, against a food processor or food producer?
I'd have to get back to you.
Okay. Seems to me, from my recollection, it's very, very unlikely. And because it's so difficult to go to court and prove these cases, they're usually settled with some slap on the wrist. I guess my time has expired. You feel that the FDA is now in a position to do more because of the rule that's finally in place, but with the food safety legislation that passed the House overwhelmingly on a bipartisan basis, that will give you the additional tools, resources, and additional legal tools to make sure this whole thing will work, and we're not going to have hearing after hearing on salmonella and peanut butter, eggs, spinach, or whatever.
Here's my bottom line. We need this bill. We need this bill to protect the safety of the food supply. We need this bill to help us prevent another egg outbreak just like the one that we've experienced and the one that that we heard from the earlier witnesses so devastated their lives.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Yet for questions, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Dr. Sharfstein, I want to talk to you about both preventing foodborne illnesses and then also quickly identifying them and removing them. Obviously, it's in all of our interest to prevent these illnesses from occurring in the first place, and I think that would be your top priority as well. Is that the main focus of the new egg rule as
Correct.
Well, preventing the salmonella from getting in the eggs? And by the way, I just wanted to clarify, it's not uncommon for salmonella to be inside the eggs, correct? It's not just on the shell of the eggs.
Yeah, I think it's well understood that one of the major routes of transmission is through the chicken into the egg.
Okay. So one thing that struck me with the previous panel testifying is they said they think it's, despite all of the other issues, the large piles of manure and et cetera, they think it's in part because of contaminated feed. Do these new egg rules address the feed issue?
The new egg rules do help with the feed issue, but let me say that FDA has not reached this conclusion that you heard earlier from
Right. I understand that, but it would seem to me, no matter what the source of the salmonella inside the egg was, be it the manure or the rodents or anything like that, whatever source it would be, if you're testing the eggs, you should be able to identify that they are contaminated, and then you wouldn't send them out, right?
That's correct.
So the testing is a big part of it.
That's correct, and it's the responsibility of the company to identify if there's a risk.
Right.
From whatever source, and then when they find the contamination, take action to control.
And then go back and figure out what caused it and remove that,
exactly.
Correct?
Exactly.
Now, the second thing I wanted to ask you is, does the FDA currently, if the Senate does not pass the food safety bill, have the resources to do all the inspections that are going to be needed under these new egg rules?
You know, as you know, FDA has been significantly strapped for resources. And, you know, you should know there are 150,000 or so domestic food facilities, and FDA does about 18,000 food inspections every year. We are prioritizing under the rule of these egg facilities, so we will do them. But the legislation, which gives us additional resources as well as additional tools, will make a tremendous difference in FDA's ability to prevent future outbreaks.
And to inspect these facilities, correct?
And to do all the inspections we're expected
okay.
to do.
Okay. Let me talk to you for a minute about then after there's contamination, after the contaminated food leaves.
Sure.
Chairman Waxman talked to you about mandatory recall authority, and as you pointed out, in this case, the company did, when told, voluntarily recall the eggs, but that is not always the case, is it? For example, the peanut butter outbreak, where the company resisted recalling the contaminated peanut butter for quite some time, and the government didn't really have the authority to do anything, correct?
I can tell you there have been definitely instances where there's been some tension between FDA and firms over doing a recall.
And just the threat of a mandatory recall might make a firm hop to and recall tainted food even on their own before the FDA had to exercise that mandatory recall authority.
FDA would intend to be extremely reasonable about using this because we understand right. people, you know, that companies could be worried. We would be reasonable, but yes, we would very much like to have that ability.
Let me talk to you about another issue that I care a lot about because I worked hard to include it in the food safety bill, and that's the traceability provisions. On our first panel, we heard one of the witnesses said, part of the problem is there's a lot of food on the plate, and we have to identify which of the food is contaminated and where it came from. But having traceability for all of those food systems that's interoperable, not necessarily the same traceability system, but systems that are interoperable, that would help the FDA more quickly identify the source of the contamination, wouldn't it?
Yes.
And that's something that the FDA doesn't have the ability to order right now under current law, correct?
That's correct.
So the food safety bill would really help more if there was food that was contaminated, it would help identify the source much more quickly and enable that recall to happen so
further
people
That's an extremely good point. I've spoken about the enforcement provisions of the bill. I've spoken about the prevention provisions of
correct.
The bill. But the trace back provisions are very important also.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Thank you, Mr. Gett. Mr. Braley for questions, please.
Dr. Sharfstein, welcome. I have a very significant constituent who lives and farms in New Hartford, Iowa, and he has made an important statement about these egg recalls. I want to read to you. The recent egg recalls have troubled consumers and weakened confidence in our nation's food supply. When Americans visit their local grocery store, they should be able to trust that the food they are purchasing to feed their family is safe to consume. That was a statement that Senator Grassley made in a letter to USDA Secretary Tom Vilsack, our former governor. Do you agree with that statement?
Yes.
Now, one of the concerns that we have is that right now, among the 50 states and the federal government, there is this hodgepodge of state requirements that relate to the production of eggs that may vary from state to state, and yet those individual state enforcement activities are part of this complementary network of food safety enforcement that we have in this country. And I would like you to share with us your opinion as to whether we can continue to rely on a system where one state's requirements may have lower thresholds of food safety, which then goes into a stream of commerce and goes around the country to other states, and whether we continue to have that, can continue to afford that type of enforcement system given the problems identified with this egg recall.
I would say that our goal is an integrated federal food safety system where we are working with our partners at the state and local level off the same playbook. And there's been a tremendous amount of work at FDA to move this forward. There was recently a 50-state meeting where we discussed what this system would look like, and the legislation would propel that forward in a number of ways. So our goal is for there to be a clear standard across the country and for the states and localities and the federal government to be in much greater sync than they are today.
What were some of the breakdowns that led to this $500 million egg recall between the FDA and the state officials in Iowa?
I'm not sure that I would describe it as breakdowns between the state officials and the FDA. I think that what FDA recognized is the importance of having clear prevention-oriented standards that then could be inspected against. And, you know, that's why very shortly after, you know, I started at FDA and the administration's food safety working group came together, the administration prioritized getting this egg safety rule out, having a period for implementation, and getting it going as quickly as possible. So our focus is on getting that in place, and that gives us the basis, the foundation, to really work closely with states and localities around clear standards. What the bill would give us is the ability to do that in other areas to reasonable standards, integrated with states and localities, to prevent illness.
And I want to talk about why this is so important. We know that every year there are about 5,000 deaths related to foodborne illness in this country. Isn't that correct?
That's correct.
And every year there are approximately 325,000 hospitalizations in this country related to foodborne illnesses. And we heard from witnesses here today about how devastating that can be to their quality of life.
That's right. And as a physician, I've taken care of patients who have died from foodborne illness.
So the other thing that we know about the bill that we passed in the House is that there is a cost sharing that goes along with this responsibility, and that most of the cost associated with the enforcement under the food safety bill we passed would be the result of fees in the food industry. Is that correct?
That's correct.
And so haven't these hearings that we've been holding in this committee, haven't they demonstrated why it's so important to save these lives and keep people out of the hospital by making food safety a higher priority in this country?
Yes, I think that the work the committee has done in this area is extremely important, and we really do appreciate the bipartisan support that this bill has gotten.
Thank you. That's all.
Thank you, Mr. Braley. Mr. Markey for questions.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, very much. As you know, Mr. DaCosta, whose Iowa facility has been implicated in this outbreak, is also tied to a number of egg processing businesses in Maine. Some of these businesses may merely rent land from Mr. DaCosta, while others may have closer ties, like purchasing chicken feed from other facilities that Mr. DaCosta runs. As I'm sure you know, facilities owned and operated by Mr. DaCosta in Maine have a long history of public health, environment, worker abuses, and animal cruelty violations. So just to be clear, have there been any recent Salmonella infections that were later linked to eggs or facilities from New England?
Not that I'm aware of, but we'll get back to you if I'm...
Okay, thank you. I think that's important for us to know. To the best of my knowledge, the answer is no,
right.
But I think we should nail that down so that residents of Massachusetts or other New England states are not concerned.
Well, let me say this. I think in the past, we have measured success or failure just by an outbreak. But the way we're looking at it now is we would like to have the assurance that there's good preventive controls
Great.
In place. And one of our priorities in doing these inspections is really getting that assurance. So not just that, you know, there isn't a massive outbreak,
mm-hmm.
but that there's actually prevention-oriented standards. And in picking which firms and which places to go, where to look first, we are going to be prioritizing companies that have had problems in the past. We will be reaching out to other agencies, and we've been working with OSHA, for example, to identify if there are findings that other agencies have had. We have an agreement with USDA that we will be learning from their inspectors. So we intend to use all the information at our disposal to prioritize which companies need an FDA visit quickly.
So just to go from the general to the specific, because I appreciate the direction which mm-hmm. the FDA is heading. So you plan to prioritize your inspections so that you start with the riskiest facilities, like those in Maine or other states that have a history of violations, or those that buy feed or chicks from companies like Mr. DaCosta or other repeat violators who own or operate.
Is that correct?
Right. We will be using a wide variety of data, including information from other agencies like USDA and OSHA, to help us prioritize the highest risk facilities.
So just to take it one step further, the Nuclear Regulatory Commission gears its inspection regime towards those who have had the longest history of violations. You intend on doing the same thing?
Absolutely.
And this main facility falls into that category?
I couldn't specifically talk about a specific facility, but I can tell you we will look at not only the history of facilities, but corporate issues. If we have concerns about a particular owner, for example, that makes us think that other farms could have a problem, that will influence our prioritization.
But if it is amongst the greatest violators, then that's where you're most likely to be going first?
Yes.
Okay, good. So that's an important, I think, and you can hear a sigh of relief going on all over New England right now because of the record there. And again, right now there's no evidence, but we want to make sure that we go in and to get the answers as quickly as possible. The gentleman who testified here today, or did not testify here today, Mr. DaCosta, clearly has no regard for regulations until the point at which he actually gets caught. You know, that's a constant refrain that we hear from people who get sworn in to testify at that table. You know, we went from BP to Salmonella, and it's a long history of witnesses at that table, and they're always then quite a concern that their actions have been misunderstood. Do you think that you can, under your current regulations, guarantee that habitual violators like Mr. DaCosta can be quickly caught and held accountable?
Well, what I testified to is that we are going to go out to these 600 facilities, but our tools, what we can do when we get there, are limited, and that the legislation that is pending would be extremely helpful for us to do the job well, because it would give us a whole other series of tools to enforce the law.
Thank you. Thank you for your service. Welcome back to our committee. And
thank you,
Mr. Chairman. I appreciate it.
Thank you, Mr. Markey. That concludes all questioning. And thank you, Dr. Sharfstein, for being here. And I want to thank all witnesses for coming today and for their testimony. The committee rules provide that members have 10 days to submit additional questions for the record to witnesses. I ask unanimous consent that the contents of our document binder be entered into the record, provided that the committee staff may redact any information that is business proprietary, relates to privacy concerns, or is law enforcement sensitive. No objection, documents will be entered. That concludes our hearing. This meeting of the subcommittee is adjourned.
Oversight Subcommittee Chairman Bart